Hey everybody, it's X-Penguin Live, and can we all take a moment to hail the returning king, Mr. Pseudo Shred?
Hail Pseudo Shred!
Yay, Pseudo Shred's back! Yay!
I have yet to ever hear this guy actually talk, though, so I don't know what you guys are talking about. Is he your imaginary friend?
Oh my gosh, I don't even know how to tackle this. If he was imaginary, how would I actually know? Would I have any method for verifying your reality?
That's true. Wow, we just got really deep right off the beginning.
I mean, like, for all they know, I could have recorded everything you're saying now, and it could just be like a random, like, I've suppressed the memory of recording it, and there's like a Raspberry Pi over here playing back what you said, and I'm just batshit crazy, and we never see you because you're just me in a dress. I'm just saying.
If I was you in a dress, can I say I would look fabulous?
Wow, you've got the legs for it, yeah? Yeah. Anyway, welcome one and all to X-Penguin. For those of you who are new to the show, I'd like to think that every episode is someone's first episode, you know? This is the show where we talk about our lives in Linux, in the context of Linux, as well as spending some time talking about the things we found interesting in a newsy-type place this week. And hopefully you will enjoy this show, and we will make lols and say insightful things. Well, I will, and then Pseudo will be here as well.
Yeah,
that's Pseudo. It. So if you're here for hardcore news, you're probably in the wrong place. So shall we move on to, you've been away for so long, you must have a massive list of games to talk to us about today, Pseudo Shred.
Oh, so, huge. I mean, it's been what? Like,
this is a month. Yeah, over a month. Yeah.
Giant list of games. Okay. That's all we're going to talk about for 2 hours are all the one game that I've played.
What? You've played one game, though, but you've played like 100 hours, I'm guessing, of this one game.
Oh, yeah. 61 hours, yeah. Minutes.
61 hour minutes. So you've played 61 hours of this game. What's this game you've played 61 hour minutes of?
Golf with Friends.
Oh, my God. So you've been away for a month, and the only thing you have to talk about is Golf with Friends.
And that's only because I was taking of the adult beverage on Friday night, and Cypher, who is a Twitch streamer, it's awesome, was getting a bunch of people to play golf with friends, and I'm like, hey, it's $6, I'll hop on that. But can I say, it is early access, so it has all the early access bugs, but for $6, holy crap, did I already make my money back in 60
yeah.
minutes.
My daughter's played loads of that game. She loves it, and she makes me play all the time. It's a really good game. It's non-violent, inoffensive. It's literally, to play, if you can hold a mouse button and move your hand forward, you can play. There's like, everyone should play this game. Like, it's one of them games that like could have been on the Wii. It's so like open to access. It's just an amazing game. And I think it runs the risk of being like, if you're just playing with like you and a buddy, I could see it get boring. But if you're playing golf with friends with like, you know, a whole bunch of people, I can definitely see that you could probably get an awful lot of time out of it. Yeah.
We ended up having, I want to say we had 7 different people all in Discord voice chat. And it was absolutely hilarious. It was just constant fun. And that's why I think it's worth $6. Like, if I would have played it by myself, then it's just a golf game and there's not much point to it. But having, you know, that environment with your friends really to be stupid. And it's just, like you said, it's just a fun, non-violent, non-political game of mini golf.
Yeah. And it's also a really good mini golf game. Like, it's actually genuinely a really well thought out mini golf game. Some of the puzzly bits of it are really clever. And and I think if you're someone who wants to play a game with your kids or with your parents, you know, it's one of those games that's perfect for that. And it's really cheap. It's like £6. It's really cheap and it's worth every penny.
Gus, were you ever really a child? I only imagine you coming out like talking about politics of the world like as soon as you popped out.
Gus is squeezed out of his mom and then leans forward and goes, how do you feel about the political situation in Chechnya? I don't know why I went with Chechnya either.
He's very connected. He's very connected to the world.
Yeah, whereas I am not, thankfully. Anyway, look, Valiant Cheese lurks in chat.
There's a Valiant Cheese.
The Valiant Cheese.
Speaking of a Valiant Cheese. Is that a good segue? Did I slip that in there under the radar where no one's going to detect it?
Okay, go for it.
Oh, the Did that just ruin
it? No, you go ahead. Go ahead.
So the only other thing, I say I only played one game over the last, you know, month and a half or whatever. But I did, I actually got really excited about the Linux Gamers game jam. And fortunately, Itch has just decided to load for me. So Hex, if you want to bring that up, it might load for you. I honestly, when he announced, so for those that don't know, the Linux Gamer is probably the biggest Linux game YouTuber right now.
He makes incredible content. The Linux Gamer is, by about 6,000 subscribers, the largest Linux gaming channel on YouTube by like quite a hefty way. I mean, I think he's at 18,000 subscribers, I want to say. But yeah, so yeah, people should. I hope people watching this know who he is.
Yeah. So he ended up announcing that he wanted to do a 5-day game jam. For those that don't know, it's where you start a game, you build a game over 5 days, and then it's done. Like, you release it and everyone gets to play it. So I was kind of worried about, you know, the kind of reception he was going to get, because let's be honest, Linux itself is very niche. A game jam is very, very niche.
Oh yeah.
He got something like 60 plus submissions. Yep. Oh, sorry, 54 submissions.
Yep.
And so I was like, oh wow. I started getting really excited about it at seeing, you know, some of the announcements of these games, and I got really excited, and I just wanted to talk about a couple of them.
I wonder which ones. One of them particularly Valiant?
Yes, one of them was particularly Valiant by some cheese. So starting with that one, actually, I didn't know what to expect. I mean, I know that Cheezus and I have talked before, and he has made the Icicle engine, which is basically like a game engine for text-based adventure games. Okay. So when I fired it up, I didn't really understand what was going on with it. This is something that everyone should play, in my opinion, because it takes your standard old text adventure, mm-hmm. but gives it kind of a UI.
Yep.
You can actually use your mouse to basically look up and look down. Yep. And as you do that, the game will change the text to say, like, I didn't understand what I was doing at first. So I was like, I move my mouse all the way up. And it's like, you see the stars.
You're like, what?
And then I moved it left and right, and it shows that I'm facing different directions, and it tells you exactly, like, you now are looking down the street and you see all this kind of stuff, and it's really charming. The thing that really got me, though, was, exactly, Valiant Cheese said it better. There's still, even when you explain it to people, you can't get it until you actually try it.
Yeah.
Like, once you realize what's going on, it's like, this is really cool. This makes a lot of sense. It's really cool. But one of the things that, like, so I was playing it, and I love humor. Like, one of my favorite games of all time is Day of the Tentacle. And we have Cheeseness here. One of the reasons I think Cheeseness is great is because he brought one of my favorite games of all time to Linux. And the reason I love that adventure game above all others is the sheer humor in it.
Yep.
And the spicy meatball saves the day has that kind of humor built into it. Like, I was walking through this fiery house, and then all of a sudden it plays this kind of music, like wah 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 kind of thing, and it explains like how you're crushed in rubble, and it brings you back to that old Space Quest kind of thing where it's like, I know licking this vial of acid is gonna kill me, but I have to do it. I need to know see how I die. Yeah.
Okay, before we go any further, I now we may be having Cheeseness on the show at some point in the very near future, so I don't want to go into too much depth on this question, but while we have him here, Cheeseness, is the Icicle engine open source? Is it sort of available for public use, or is it just something you allow people to use occasionally? Because I know other games have been made in the engine. So while we wait for it, let's carry on, Mr. Sudo, while we wait for the 30-second Twitch delay to catch up.
Oh, I loved it, Valiant Cheese. Hopefully you're saying that you're not going for, like, you meant to be drama, but I found it to be, when the first time I died, I just started cracking up laughing because of the music in the background and the way that was described.
It would have been like gold if he had gone, that was supposed to be a serious piece of drama.
Whoopsie.
He was like, I laughed my ass off. It was, you dick.
It was great. I loved it.
Yeah. I've had a little look at the Icicle engine because I'm planning doing a video on a couple of the games individually. So I've had a little bit of a look at it, and I've spoke with Cheeseness about it. It's a very impressive engine, and his and the attitude he's taken towards a very old concept has really sort of brought fresh life to it, which I think is really interesting. Yeah, he was intended to be funny. Totally not meant to be. Still, see, he answered your question, but still hasn't answered my question about whether the engine's open source or not. Dude, I mean, it's fine.
I assume so.
So, well, I always assume everything's open source, and then it ends badly.
Yeah.
So was there any other games you want to talk about? Yeah.
Yeah. Actually, I was actually very surprised at the quality of some of these games. So, actually, the first one I played. So, sadly, a lot of them. Oh, it's not open source.
No.
He's considering it. That's fine. Sadly, a lot of the games that came into the game jam, I couldn't get running, but I didn't, like, if I clicked install and it didn't run, then, or like when I kicked play, it didn't run, then I kind of moved on because I didn't have a lot of time. So I just wanted to check them all out. So I've only played a handful of the games. One of the first games I played was The Mansion. Okay. This is a first-person shooter game.
A first-person shooter made in that short amount of time. What's it called? The Mansion?
Yeah.
Oh, I found it.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying is, like, so, I mean, there's not a lot to it. You know, it's basically just one room with a couple of adjoining rooms, and then ghosts spawn and you kill them. But for 5 days, I was blown away.
Wow, that font,
was amazing.
Though. They've got the pixel font on the... I hate the pixel font. Fucking pixel font. Looking pixel font. Look at the game. I haven't played this. This looks all right. It looks all right. It already doesn't look like Unity asset flips, so it's better than 90% of stuff on Steam.
That's one of the things is a lot of the games built Unity, and of the games that built Unity that I tried, they worked. So, I mean, there is a good reason to use Unity, because for me, at least, all the Unity games just seem to work. And I have any issues with them. So I highly recommend people to check out, you know, all of these games. They're on itch. You can go check them out. It's really great. We have the link in the show note docs for the actual page. For those that don't know, Samsai. So if you guys don't know Samsai is like the co-host of Gaming on Linux when they do streaming, but he also does some articles. Him and Tumox wrote a game together. Tumox is one of the guys that goes in Gaming on Linux, and they called it Sauna Simulator 2018. I don't know why 2018, but it's basically you're these two guys sitting next to each other, and you're just kind of trying to out-health the other guy. So you have these numbers above your head, and you can add heat or you can add water to the sauna, and your numbers start to go down. And every once in a while, you can drink some water to raise them back up. And you can also throw beer bottles at the other person. And it's just basically trying to outpace. It's weird. It's so weird. It took me 3 times before I beat it. But it was just it caught my attention because it was so odd. Yeah, it's hydration rather than health. Okay, so it's hydration rather than health.
Okay. All of these games, what's surprising me is none of them look terrible. I mean, some of them look really fucking indie, but none of them I look at and I go, that looks shit.
Yeah.
Terminal Arena Shooter.
I can't do any of this. So they all kind of blew me away. One of the ones that really caught my eye immediately. So I'm a huge Master of Orion fan. The original Master of Orion is also one of my favorite games of all time.
Yep.
And someone started to build something of a clone called Olymporion. Olymporion? I'm not sure how you pronounce this. But it actually, like, looking at the screenshot, this already starts to look like the original Master of Orion. And I was like, yes, please.
That's cool. What's it called again? How are you spelling that? Oh, I found it. Never mind. I found it. I scrolled and found it. It does look like the original Master of Orion. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of it's not integrated, but again, the guy had 5 days to do this, and I'm actually going to keep an eye on this. I hope that he continues to build this out, because the one thing I've wanted for the last 20 years is for someone to rebuild the original Master of Orion with a new interface, but have it look the same.
Yeah, yeah.
Just, and with all the same functionality, but maybe add a couple of features.
Just like fix the problems in it.
Yeah. Take the original game, fix the problems,
wait,
and then I will be.
Don't you
happy.
Mean the Master of Orion reboot on Steam? Surely that addresses your problem.
Doesn't exist.
There is, well, there's no Master of Orion reboot on Steam. No? None. Okay. Yeah. I could tell the sadness, and you've always like ruined your vibe for the show now because I mentioned it.
Yeah. We'll just skip that because I don't want to get into a rant.
Well, Retro Island War looks pretty cool. Again, what's with the fucking pixel font? I hate this. Right, as a dyslexic, guys, if ever you make a game, please don't use this font. This is unreadable to me. I have to wheel to the side of the room to read this shit. This is just symbols to me. I can't read this. Sorry, rant. They're talking about rants.
Yeah, that's one of them I actually couldn't get playing.
That looks pretty cool.
I didn't play that one. The only other two I wanted to mention was one called My Boring Game.
Way to set expectations high, right? Way to set expectations high. Call it My Boring Game.
Yeah. I was kind of like, well, My Boring Game, like you're kind of hard on yourself. And then I looked, and for those that know him, he's around a lot. It's by Rice.
Okay.
That Rice is nice, or he also goes by Air Roz. Rice is nice. It's actually really impressive. It's a 3D kind of platformer.
Right.
But the thing that really caught me. He built it in Godot, but the thing that really caught me is, for those that don't know Rice, he has this very monotone kind of voice. Like even when he's joking, he's a very controlled person, but he used that to his advantage to create comedy in the game. Like That's he cool. actually does voiceover in the game, and he's like at one point, like, so I only have 5 days and I didn't have a chance to actually build this out. So just imagine this. And he like paints this view of what he wants to happen with it. And it's just so funny.
That's cool.
It's great. It's okay. It's a really quirky game. So you guys got to check that one out.
I'll be adding this to the list then for me to play.
And the last one I want to mention, is called Blast Off.
Oh, look, that's convenient. It's already on the page.
Blast Off. There's almost nothing to blast off. It graphically is very simple. There's a very simple control scheme, just left and right, but basically you're a guy with a jetpack that is firing up and you have to dodge asteroids.
Loading the website, loading that page has basically crippled my browser.
Get further than my last.
Yeah, loading that web page basically crippled my browser and started making my audio go weird. So I don't know what the fuck Firefox is doing with that web page, but we'll just assume it's a Firefox thing. Actually, Nisui, that is already on my list of things. That is genuinely already on my list. Don't worry about that. I will definitely be taking a look at that probably tomorrow afternoon when I've got some time. As Nisui has said a couple of times in chat, it's interesting because we've got some Linux-exclusive games here. Because of who it is running the game jam, some of these people didn't feel the need to build Windows versions, which I think is fine. I'm fine with that. I'm totally fine with that, yeah.
Well, that's, so there was one that some people were kind of saying was cheating, and that's like Particles or something like that, I think the game is called, because the game already existed. They just built a Linux build for the game jam. It's like, that's not...
Yeah,
really,
well, it's not really in the spirit of the jam, is it?
No, it's a great game. It is. It's very interesting, but it's not in the spirit of the jam whatsoever. So it's up to you guys whether you check it out. Armor Heart Valiant Cheese. I don't think I got that one working. A lot of them I didn't get working, but again, I didn't spend more than 20 seconds trying to get them working. So they probably, a lot of them could work really easily. Those were just the ones that kind of stood out in my mind as exceptional. And especially in 5 days, being made in 5 days, just it blew me away.
Interesting stuff. Yeah, no, I'm definitely gonna be checking this out. And as I just said, I've got a video planned. I think I will be specifically targeting the ones that are Linux only in my coming video for it. But to be honest, whatever video I make, the actual Linux game has already made a much better video anyway. So I will be just cursory looks at them really. Because obviously he's done a massive amount of content to do with this, and it's all pretty good as well. So definitely check that out, guys.
The Linux Gamer did try to do a live stream, but his internet's so bad that it turned out not so great. He did a handful of the games, so you can go check it out. But I believe he's going to be doing some more in-depth videos of his reactions to them, because they're. It blew me away in 5 days what people could put together and how many different kind of submissions. Like I expected just to see like nonstop platformers because platformers are easy to build, right?
Yeah.
And there are some good platformers in there, but just the range of different games is just, it's astounding. It was so much fun. Thank you, Linux Gamer, for putting that together.
I would love to build a game. I've got ideas for games and I feel like I want to put some time into it, but I feel like perhaps I might just buy RPG Maker now it's on Linux and just do it that way. Because I keep looking at Godot, and I've loaded it up a couple of times and gone, let's figure out Godot. Godot. And I keep looking at it, though, and I load it up, and I'm going to figure this out. And then after 5 minutes, I'm going, or I could not do that. Because it's so much above my level, where like I might just like do something in RPG Maker, because I definitely do want to put... I've got some ideas for things I want to put out there, and seeing these game jams, just seeing what other people can do in 5 days makes me want to put at least 6 days in, see if I can make something as, you know, in the same ball. I'll put 5 weeks in and get something as good as these guys made in 5 hours, probably.
Yeah, you couldn't... you probably couldn't even figure out how to use RPG Maker in 6 days, Hex.
I don't know.
Not
I'm,
that I've ever done. I don't know.
I've used RPG Maker in the past, and I figured it out early on. I watched a YouTube video.
So Cody the Dragon Dude is saying that he doesn't believe there should be anything other than just Linux games. Like it's a Linux game jam. I don't agree with that. I agree with Valiant Cheese. Like this isn't like you have to build a game just for us. No, this is you have to build a game that also works with us and let's, you know, we're all Linux folks, so let's focus on that. And I think like it sounds like Cheeseness kind of takes the same route as Valve that, you know, you shouldn't limit to one kind of thing just because you're trying to spite the others.
Yeah, exclusives, like, even when it comes to game jams, as much as I'm going to point out that it's cute that a few people made Linux only builds, and especially if they've made an engine from scratch that they've built on Linux. Thank you, Commander Jim P is now hosting me. Thank you. But I think that exclusionism is bad, and as Linux users, we should understand that better than anyone. Because how many times have you been pissed off that he was excluded from that game you really want to play? So yeah, I don't think they necessarily had to make Windows versions, but I don't think they should lose points for making a Windows version.
Yeah, no. And there was, they even said on the page, like, you get bonus points for doing certain things, and they're like, but no one actually wins, so the points don't matter. it's a lot of fun.
Yeah,
so,
pretty cool. Pretty cool. Definitely. I'm scrolling up and down this page too much, and I'm probably making people feel seasick, but I'm kind of like reading it as I'm going up and down. So yeah. Anyway, let's get away with that. So I take you've been off for a month. You must have played other things as well. You must have been a phone game you was given a go to.
No, I don't do phone games.
Yay. Tobarexi is now following me. Thank you, dude. Tobarex. I think I said that right. I tried. Thank you for the follow. I also do YouTube.
Huh?
Telling Tom Rex, I also do YouTube. You could probably find that if you wanted to. So yeah, sorry, carry on. You don't do phone games.
I don't do phone games because there's no value to them in my opinion. Like I when I play a game I like to feel invested in it, and all of the phone games are just very thin.
Yeah.
There's not like it's like once you do level one, you know how the entire rest of the game goes, and it's just rehashing level one, and I just get more frustrated than anything at that kind of crap. So no, I literally did not play anything else. When was the last time we even had a X-Penguin together? I think it was like a month and a half ago,
yeah,
right?
I
literally did not play anything in a month and a half.
Wow. Now I know you mean phone games, because for me, if there's a game on a phone that's particularly good, I wish it was on my 3DS. That's basically I am. So for me, my 3DS literally lives in my pocket. And like if I go anywhere, I'll just play a 3DS game. Or Switch now, but that's hard to get in your pocket. So, you know, there's that. And there's only one game for that anyway, so there's probably not much point. Anyway, but also while you was off, though, you got to watch 6 Linux streams on the same time on Twitch.
Do you have that screenshot?
I'm not sure I do. Let me see if I can find it. Well, do you remember where you posted it? Did you post it directly to me? I don't remember.
I want to say I posted it. No, I might have posted it in the Linux game.
Oh, in that case, I don't stand a chance of finding it.
It doesn't matter.
He basically had a screenshot where he literally had all of the streamers open, you know, their own windows, and it was just ridiculous, the amount of faces you could see across there. But I think it's quite an interesting point, because there was a point in time where there wouldn't have been 6 at all, would there? And
no.
Now all of a sudden, yeah. So
that's,
all of a sudden,
and I mean, I'm the true believer. Like I want us to get to a point where people consider that Linux is a viable platform. And, you know, when I first started streaming on Linux to Twitch, I was one of the very few. Shadow Sigan has been there for like forever.
Yeah.
But I was one of the very few. So to get, and I'm constantly looking for other Linux Twitch streamers. So to get to six, I posted the
simultaneously.
I was literally watching six Linux streamers across three of my monitors simultaneously, and I was just giddy. I was giddy like a schoolgirl. I was so excited. There are that many people that were picking up speed and traction. Now, six in terms of the thousands, if not tens of thousands, that Twitch has, again, isn't a lot, but I was so excited to see that there are that many people that were streaming at that time.
Yeah, it's interesting, and it's quite remarkable when, like, at one point there was probably six Linux streamers, and now there were six all at once. I mean, and if you look in the Linux, for anyone who doesn't know, we have a Linux Discord group, a Linux Gamer Discord group. The link is available on the bottom of all of my videos. If you go there, I mean, you can see our streaming page there is constantly alive with people like posting, and we're always adding new people to the bot to the point where it's, you know, it's an alive, vibrant community. It's pretty cool that this is happening. So I do feel like, I think it'll be interesting to see who gets to be the first Twitch partner. Is it Twitch partner, they call it? The first partnered one will be really interesting to see. But I wonder who that will be. Everyone should come watch me, so it's me, and then give me all the bits. And
okay, so yeah, Cheese says he's been streaming stuff since 2014, actually.
Oh, sorry, look at that Cheese being ahead of the curve, streaming your stuff to everyone, just doing cool stuff and being cooler than us. There's a shock.
But yeah, Gus, I have three monitors. They're all different size and all different resolutions, so it drives me nuts. But I have three monitors. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you should have said you had
one really widescreen monitor to impress everyone.
That'd be really widescreen.
Really widescreen. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, no, so we found this. Hex already had the screenshot.
I did have the screenshot. I could have posted it too.
I gave it to him.
Yeah, sorry.
But so Valiant Cheese streams on Hitbox, mm-hmm. so you guys can go follow him.
Yep.
But yeah, I was super excited. And then a little thing over the last month of, you know, just getting my RHC, which that's no big deal.
I don't know. It's no big deal, is it? I mean, like, you're like a Red Hat professional now, aren't you? Is that what they say? A Red Hat professional? Yeah. You're qualified at Linux now.
Qualified at Red Hat. Some people would say that you would need the Linux Foundation's certs, but I mean, I work for Red Hat, so.
I don't know. I think if Linus Torvalds dies and gets hit by a bus, I reckon you could probably replace him.
Not in the least. Like, I don't even know anything about the kernel.
Yeah, you don't even know what it is.
I don't have a clue what his daily job is.
I don't know what the Linux is, but I'm qualified to do it. So congratulations on that anyway. On being probably the most qualified Linux dude on this stream right now. I don't know that. I'm guessing. I think Cheeseness probably is more qualified than you. I don't know. I'm guessing. Probably.
Yeah.
Like, even if he doesn't have qualifications, he's still cooler than you in every way. So I don't know if that.
I agree. I 100% agree on that.
Nusui is also smarter than us. So
there's a lot of people.
Yeah. So now I come to think. Now I come to think of it, it's not a big deal. Well, yeah, no, in all seriousness, congratulations, because it's a damn sight more Linux qualifications than I will ever have. I guarantee you that much.
Thank you.
And yeah, and it looks cool. Did you get your Red Hat yet, though?
Oh, yeah, I've had my Red Fedora for months.
That's cool. Okay. Fair enough, then. So still running you're still running that one?
Antergos, yeah.
There you go.
Yeah,
I don't know why I can't say it. It's like an illness.
Other than that CA certification blip, you know, that Arch had, what was it, last week? I've had no issues with it whatsoever. It's freaking amazing.
Yep.
It just blows me away. I love it. I when I see that little update icon, I'm like, I'm getting new stuff.
It's not GNOME. Is GNOME
I'm actually? Waiting for GNOME 24 or 3.24. I can't wait for that to hit. I will absolutely update immediately.
I've said it on before on the show. My policy is never to update within 3 days of a show. So I never update from Thursday. I haven't updated. So I had this problem where I thought GNOME was going to drop, and the new version of GNOME was going to be sitting there in the update, and I'd be like, I want to click it so bad. Just I want to click it so bad. But thankfully, that hasn't happened. So shall we move on to what I've played this week, shall we?
Yes, sir.
Is that something?
This Fortnite.
Okay. This Fortnite, indeed. I can say Fortnite. I'm qualified to say Fortnite.
I'm not allowed to say Fortnite.
No. You can't say Fortnite. You say Fortnite, which is a different thing, I think.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, Fortnite. The fort with the knights in it.
Oh, there you go. Cody the Dragon Dude got saved by Antagos on the AUR by having Kernel 4.4 available.
Yeah. Yeah, Cody the Dragon Dude uses a black magic capture device, and it's been broken for quite a while. And he, what was it, Cody? 9 months, I think you said you've been working on this.
Wow.
Trying to get them to address it, and then they finally pushed an update or something like that. So now it compiles again on a newer Linux kernel.
Wow. So, yeah, you got a lot more patience than me. I really wish that I had HDMI capture and stuff set up, but it's all, I keep looking at it all, and it's so expensive. It's so fucking, and I just keep using OBS. Because as much as like I have problems with OBS, at least it's not costing me a fortune, and I don't have driver problems. So, you know, there's that. But is your Blackmagic working properly now? Can we assume it's working properly?
I believe he said he was able to get it compiled now.
Doesn't mean it's working. Yeah. It's compiled. This week, these last fortnight, I have played way more Adventure Capitalist than I'm actually.
Not a game.
Yeah, not a game. Not a game. I don't know if I've spoken publicly about my clicker problem though. Some people drink, some people smoke, some people inject.
Clicker.
I click. And I try not to ever load a clicker, because when I do, I get in a deep, dark hole where that's all that's on one screen for about 2 weeks. And fucking, I was clean. I knew what this was, and I didn't touch it. And then DK, Dark Emperor in the Discord group, Gate was like, I was talking about games I should probably do videos on. He was like, you should totally do Adventure Capitalist. I've been telling you this loads. And I was like, oh, fuck's sake.
You said it perfectly yesterday. You don't play a clicker. Yeah. You monitor a clicker. Yeah.
You attend a clicker. It plays itself. You're just
attend,
there.
That's
yeah.
What I was
you
saying.
Attend.
Yeah.
An Adventure Capitalist is a great clicker. It's a really well balanced, well thought out clicker that gives you lots of reasons to click, and it self clicks after a certain point, so you can just sit and chill out and watch it click. And yeah, you literally just attend.
So it's literally just a an electric bill adjuster.
Because
it just sits there and runs and charges you electricity. Why don't you do something like folding at home, where you can actually get use your machine for something.
If they gamify folding at home, I'm all fucking in. you give me some bright colors and an interesting cha-ching sound when I click something.
Yeah.
Sold. Until then, fuck you, Disney Science.
Screw mankind.
Adventure Capitalist. I've done a video on it already for anyone that's interested. But basically, you start off with a lemonade stand, and you click the button, and it makes lemonade, and you get money, right? And it goes pretty quick. So click money, click money. Then you have enough money to get the lemonade stand to click itself by hiring a manager. I shit you not, this is the game. And then you can upgrade the lemonade stand to get more money per lemonade. And then you can buy, I don't remember the next one. Is the next one like a cart? No, paper round. And you click the paper button to deliver papers. Then you hire a manager for that. And then you can upgrade it. So you're making money to spend money on making more money. And then you get to a certain point where you made loads of money. And they give you the option to restart with these things called angels, which is a separate type of currency. And for every angel you've got, you get 4% extra money for your clicks, right? And it's bullshit. No one should play it. It's a horrendous piece of shit. It's an addiction, not a game. It's Jesus Christ. Even the description on Steam tells you this, right? It says, have you ever found yourself queuing up for your favorite interactive adventure? Only wish you had something to fill the empty space? We've got the ideal game for you. Adventure Capitalist, the game you play while other games are playing. It's like, they know what they are. They know exactly what they are. But yeah, I've done like 18 hours so far, and it's still fucking I'm ashamed.
Before
that, I played like Secura Clicker with the girls. I played that for like 18 hours. I played Time Clickers for like 120 hours. Yeah, if there's a clicker out there, I've probably lost a week to it for no reason, and I'm ashamed.
Me too. If you ever need to test a mouse to see if a mouse click button is working, you know, you could just test it in your settings, or you could fire up a clicker game and just click a million times.
Yeah, it's basically if you're like me and you're like ex drinker and you're prone to getting addicted to shit, don't load clickers.
It could be. Yeah, your addiction could be way worse. But I mean, like these are on cell phones too, and it's like that's the kind of thing that I stay away from because there's really nothing to them. But at least they know that they're just in the background, kind of a thing. There's a million clickers out there, and some of them take themselves like way too serious.
This one doesn't, which is why like I quite enjoyed it, because it knows it's fucking stupid. Yeah. You know, it knows what it is. But yeah, I just don't ever play it. If something's got the tag clicker on Steam, right? Just don't click it. Just don't load it. It's going to just be a piece of shit. That's my advice. I'm not going to follow that advice because I'm weak and I just like the pretty lights and sounds, all right? So that's I know my problem, right? And I'm not fucking
DK. Hex needs his pretty.
I need my pretty, which is why I keep Pseudo Shred around. other than that, I've got a video coming probably. I'm going to be making it tomorrow, but it's coming probably Thursday. Mass Effect 1 in wine. Is something I've been experimenting in. And again, wine's doing a solid, and these are games about that age of Mass Effect are pretty much perform. It pretty much performs better than it does in Windows at this point. Because when I tried to play Mass Effect 1 before I came to Linux in like 2013, I was still on Windows. Yeah, that must be about right. It wouldn't run. I couldn't get it to run in 1080p, and then it stretched and it went. It all basically was horrible. In wine, you just go, run it, and you just go 1080p, and it goes, all right then. And it's fine, and it genuinely plays better than it does in Windows.
So to go back to the clicker thing really quick, Cody the Dragon Dude said, find a way to make it auto-click. There are ways, and
I told
Hex this.
But you can pay in-game to do that.
There's a tool in Linux called XDo Tool that will allow you to set up any kind of keyboard combinations. I've actually used it before to have... To refresh a page on a website when I was doing work, and that was just the quickest and easy way to do it. XDo Tool, you guys should check it out if you want to cheat at clickers. Anyway, Mass Effect, yeah, it's not on Linux. I'm not paying attention anymore.
No, but I mean, I think it's interesting where these older games of this 10-year-old games now, Windows seems to have they don't have the backward compatibility to run these correctly anymore.
Oh, yeah, no.
Whereas Wine, they still run fantastically in Wine. They run superb in Wine. And I'm going to get a video coming which just outlines how to get Mass Effect running, what performance to expect, and there's a sound bug and you have to edit an INI file, so I'm going to put that in my video too. But I am going to I'm planning on releasing like one Wine video a week and like have an actual series of like old-ass games
Wine
that I
Wednesdays?
Wanted to play. Wine Wednesdays. That's amazing. We should do that. Yeah. Wino Wednesdays.
Not me, you.
I should do that. Thank you for... I'm taking that. That's your idea? My idea.
When you become a millionaire, I'll make sure to sue you like millions of times.
Man, when I become a millionaire, I'm sharing the love with Pseudo. As soon as I start making the big YouTube money, I'm sending him t-shirts with my face on. You can have as many as you want.
So I'll have something to burn in the winter to keep me warm.
You can do what you like, but I guarantee sooner or later you'll be out in public wearing it, and then people will go, "What's that?" And you'll go, "This is an English potato." And and I'll go, seems legit. Yeah. Nice. I found what No One Lives Forever on Lutris, which is a modern what? Which is a game, modern Windows. Yeah. So yeah, Cody the Dragon Dude said he's played No One Lives Forever in Lutris via Wine, and or in Wine via Lutris, I should say. And yeah, it works better than Windows. So, yeah, there's a few of them, and this is what I'm hoping to explore in my new series of videos, Wine Wednesdays, which I totally thought of on my own.
It's amazing, Hex. Yes, how did you figure that out?
I know. That's I've got this imaginary friend that tells me this shit. It's amazing. He's really useful.
There's just something with alliteration. I just love alliteration. So,
a big fan of DC Comics. Yeah. Okay. So so the next one I played, because I don't want to talk too much about Mass Effect, but actually I never played Mass Effect the first time round. It's a good fucking game, isn't it? It's really good.
Never played any.
It's really good. And I played briefly. I wanted to talk about. I've been playing Unepic on stream, right? And Unepic. The reason I mentioned Unepic is because some things happened in Unepic. Some shit went down in Unepic, right? And I did not expect it. I genuinely was stunned. But there's in Unepic. There's a goblin sex scene, and I really.
It's not even.
it's just, it's just
It's not even a goblin sex scene. It's like a goblin orgy scene.
Yeah, it's so this game, like, it's like, I don't think the game is inherently that good, but it's my kind of bad. You know, like Unepic is, it's like a dungeon thing where you explore a dungeon. It's like very Metroidvania, but it's got this sense of humor that sometimes is a bit cringy, but other times it's so fucking on point that you're just like, bravo, bravo. Like, he gets the chance to get involved in repopulating a race because he's ugly and they think he's a goblin. So he decides, okay, and he just walks into this room where there's three goblin women in separate cubicles, and he just like goes in, pulls the curtain across. You hear what it sex sounds. You can't say it's anything else. He opens the curtain, stark bollock naked, dangling sausage in the wind. And as you move, his little sausage is like flapping against his leg. It's like slapping against his leg as he runs. And it's just so fucking funny. I was stunned by it. I didn't know what to say. I've never been found speechless. It was so far away from what I expected that I was just, I was just on the stream. I was just going, so this is happening then. And obviously I didn't leave the room. I went to the other two cubicles and did the same thing because you have to. But it just left me stunned. I didn't know what to say.
This is a game like I don't think I would ever pick up, because while the humor is good sometimes.
Yeah.
Like the other times, like you said, it's just really cringy. Like they're trying too hard to make it funny. And then it doesn't have all that great of looks. The combat.
It's janky, yeah. It's really janky.
It's not
one
good.
Of the problems with the combat is you hit tab to target stuff, but it only works when you can see the thing you're targeting. Now, some things shoot as soon as they see you, so sometimes you just have to take the damage while you're targeting something. And even then, like the targeting is so there's no gradient to it. You just hit tab, and if you can see it, it'll target it. So if you go, I want to target the thing behind that, you just have to keep yammering on tab and hope it locks on. The combat is basically hitting space bar at the right time. And the maze, and there's a couple of things, like there's at one point there's a lift that goes up and down.
And, oh my god, that was vicious.
Yeah, and basically you have to make this ridiculous jump. Well, I estimate you've got like a 5 pixel gap to actually make this jump. And if you fail, you fall to the bottom. So instead of the lift just coming back for you, you have to wait for the lift to go to the top and then come all the way down for you again. Like, they don't have a thing to just stop the lift where you want it, which would have been an obvious one. It was a nightmare, but there's something about the game that I'm really enjoying, and I can really and because it's like turn-based almost, you can sort of, if you're in an empty room, you can just leave it. I can then interact with chat, so I find it a really great game for streaming.
And for the price that they're going for, it's not unreasonable, and especially if it goes on sale, I could definitely see it being worth it, but I don't know. And I agree with Valiant Cheese. If there are more spicy meatballs in there, that would make it better. And Gus, that looks delicious, and I haven't eaten yet today, and you're making me hungry.
What?
He posted food in there. Yeah, it's fries with mayo and sausage and gravy. Oh, it looks so good.
No problem, chat. Well, let's look at Gus's food. That looks like that looks very unhealthy, Gus. That does not look like something you should be proud to eat.
That's why it looks so good.
Okay. Okay. I'm not a fan of sausage. Anyway, being a vegetarian and half potato.
Oh yeah, that's true.
I'm not fond of both these things. The only other one I really wanted to talk about, was I am now pronouncing Doom 2016 multiplayer dead on arrival. It's dead. I've been a big fan of it since Wine allowed me to play it online, and I tried getting a game the other day, and it seems like there's not enough people playing to make it a viable experience. So I just thought that was interesting. As a public service, don't buy that game for multiplayer. It's dead, essentially.
Yeah, but the single player itself is way worse.
I said this yesterday, and people sort of like thought I was talking shit here, but Doom 2016 is the best single player shooter ever. Like, just, I can't think of a better single player campaign. It is the best. I've played it twice through in entirety, and it is the best single player experience you can have in a first person shooter. And I know people are going, Half-Life 2 with pitchforks. You played Half-Life 2 recently? It ain't all that. The reason it's not all that was,
it doesn't.
Yeah. It was great because they came up with all these amazing ideas, right? And I'm not taking anything away from them. They came up with amazing ideas. But since that time, people have stolen those ideas, right? And now they've used them to make better games. Whereas Doom 2016 scales it right the way back to Doom 1994. and it's just it's about killing shit for the pleasure of killing shit, and right? It does it for me.
It looks beautiful.
Yeah, it just totally does it for me. The map design is about the best. There's sometimes there's not an obvious way to go, so they just put a fucking light there to tell you which way to go because they're not trying to make it stressful. And the combat chest, this push forward combat they have, I genuinely believe it's the best first person shooter I've ever played. And people think I'm blowing smoke and like I'm just like, nah, man, he's stoned or something. But no, really, it's that good and it runs so well in Linux, it may as well be native.
Yeah, and Half-Life 2 at the time were amazing. Just like the original Doom when it came out was amazing, and the original Wolfenstein when it came out was amazing. But you still don't call, you wouldn't go back and look at Wolfenstein today and say, this is the best first-person shooter ever. Like, no. That doesn't mean that in the future there won't be something better, but in your opinion, this does everything right and takes it to the next level and brings back that Doom feel. And
It's like it had the same impact on me now that Doom did in 1994. Like, it did that thing where I went, holy shit, this is important. And with Doom 1994, I don't think it stands up to people who didn't play it at the time now, but I think it's worth saying that it's the most important first-person shooter of all time. Doom 2016 is not, whereas Doom 1994 is the most important historically, where Doom 2016 brings that concept bang up to date and allows players who didn't play Doom originally to know what the vibe was and what the power of the game was. It gives you that same feeling as you play it, and no other game captured that since. And this is just my Doom fanboy section, I suppose. But
very well put. Yeah. Cheese asks a good question. How many people do you need for the multiplayer? Is it that kind of game that you can't get enough mates together for a game? Now,
yeah, you could. You absolutely could.
You don't have any real life friends.
No, but I don't have any friends. I'm not very likable, and I'm not very likable. It's because I'm bald, I think. You probably could. If you had enough people in a room, if you had like 16 people who all wanted to play, you could probably totally get a game together. But one of the things I was enjoying with Doom 2016 was just jumping into the multiplayer and just playing a few rounds, then moving on with my day. And I really enjoyed like to put some Nirvana on and just play Doom for a couple of hours. And I can't do that now. And that aspect of the game, that like drop in, get a game, enjoy. Now the only people that are playing, there's like, I think I was actually wrote down, I was screen capturing the names. I was on my phone, I was taking pictures of them. I was basically coming across like three sets of people playing. And there was all so ridiculously good at the game that it wasn't fun for me anymore. There seems to be very few people outside of that core group that's playing. So unless you're in that core group and you're that good, it's not really that much fun.
I mean, it doesn't really surprise me, you know, in what are we in 2017 now, that there's not that many people, because a lot of games are geared specifically for PvP.
Yep.
Where something like this, it seems like
it was a bolt-on.
Hey, we have all these technologies. And our executive is telling us we need multiplayer to push it, you know, our producer or whatever. So let's add it in there really quick. We know no one's going to play it for the long term, but.
And also Cody says, is it dead or is everyone playing multiplayer on consoles? Same thing. I ain't playing a shooter with a fucking console pad. I'm not insane. Not doing that. So yeah, it might as well be dead, because the only way I'm going to play it, the only way I might play on a console is if it comes to the Switch, which is massively unlikely. And even then, I'm not sure the multiplayer would sustain it. So, and as for Wolfenstein, we are talking about like the 1992 Wolfenstein, not the New Order thing. We're talking about the original Wolfenstein. If people are old enough, Wolfenstein did this trick that Doom is credited for, where people went, holy shit, this is like real life. You know, people were like, holy shit, I'm looking through his eyes. And then it was 1994 when Doom came and just double barrel shotgunned that to the face and sort of showed people how good it could be. And then obviously 2 years later than that, we had Quake. So anyway, I could do a whole podcast about Doom if I'm totally honest. So let's move on. I might do. That'd be a great video. I'll do like a 2-hour podcast on Doom. I could totally sustain that. The 2D. No, it's not 2D. It was pseudo 3D. It was Raycast. Yeah. It was fine. So the only other game I wanted to mention was, have you heard of an open source game called Flare?
I have not. This is the first I've heard of it.
Yeah, Flare. Oh, let's see if I can find it. Flare is a open source Diablo style game. There we go. I found it. There we go. Flare is this open source game. It's available on all the relevant platforms. And it's basically Diablo 2. essentially. It's kind of Diablo 2-ish. It's really interesting. I'm not sure I'm particularly enamored with it, but I definitely like the fact it exists, and I'm definitely something I'm going to be playing a lot more of just to sort of get a good vibe for it. Because with all these sort of Diablo-style games, it's when you have got past learning the basics and you're into like the timings of your abilities and stuff that Diablo shines. And if this game does that right, then it'll definitely be worth looking at. But yeah, definitely worth checking
out. I've never been a Diablo person. I've tried because I've known so many people that loved it. I'm like, I can't do it. But this looks interesting. Are we at least going to get a Hex video of it?
Oh yeah, definitely one coming. But with the some games, I feel like I need a first launch. Like if a game is something that like Brainout was something I played this week, which is like 2D Counter-Strike. I felt like I could look at it after about 30 seconds and go, okay, I know what I'm doing. And as soon as I get to that point, I'm like, okay, we'll do an early look video. But something like this, where I think that I know as someone who played a lot of Diablo, that it's all about that mid-game, and it's all about, once you know how to play, it's about honing that playing. I think I'd be doing a disservice to the game to actually just do a first look at it.
Cheesness said it as well, and I was doing a search trying to find this, and one of the first search terms I find is, it's actually an engine itself, Free Libre Action Role Playing Engine. Mm-hmm. So to see that, and they're using the same website, so it's
part of the same thing.
They've built a game with their engine to show off their engine. I think is great.
So if the game's not that great, it doesn't mean the engine's discredited. But to be honest, again, as I said, I've got it in my head that I want to make a game of some sort. So I'm all of a sudden a lot more interested in these engines and how they work and stuff. It's all interesting stuff. And there's a button here on the website that says create.
If only we knew some people that made video games that could help you with
that. We knew loads of smart people.
No, we don't know anyone.
In all fairness though, even on the website, there's some really great tutorials here about how to do it, and you can make isometric tiles in Blender, and you know, there's all sorts of good stuff and definitely interesting stuff. I'm not actually ready to make a video yet. I do want to give it more time before I do that, and it seems to be relatively well developed.
Jesus, yeah. I love that face.
Yeah. I've never seen one pull that face in real life, but one day I hope to. But one thing I wanted to add as public service is the game Superstar Path does not appear to run. It's an interesting looking, let me see if I can find it for you guys. It was an interesting sort of pixel art game, Superstar Path, that I found on sale on Steam. Superstar Path. It doesn't appear to run in Arch though, in Arch based distros. It seems to not work.
But it's in Steam.
Yeah, it's a Steam game, and it uses some weird libraries, some curl libraries that are out of date, so it's a absolute ball ache to get them in. So I don't want to refund it. I kind of want to play it because it's like part match 3 game, part like shooter. It looks really interesting, and it's like so cheap. It's like £3. It's like nothing. It's like a cup of coffee price at the moment. I just thought it looked really interesting, so I do want to get it working, but it doesn't seem like it's as straightforward as install and hit play, which is unfortunate, and a bit of an oversight on Steam's QA.
I have to say, absolutely love the graphics in this. It
yeah, that's why
really
I bought it,
feels
yeah.
like Mega Man style, bright colors, but yet that's still like 8-bit kind of look. It looks beautiful, but it's a puzzle shmup. I would never pick this up.
Yeah, this is exactly the sort of thing where I'll like just get really fucking caffeinated and waste 5 hours in, though, isn't it? This is what my channel is built around, Sudo. This is my brand.
So you'll play this while you're waiting for your clicker game to get to the next level, right? Is that what you're saying? Yes. This is a filler game for your clicker.
This is a filler for my clicker, yes. And actually, that's interesting as well. Nusui noticed that Star Wars The Old Republic isn't on this list this week. Interesting. I had a month subscription on that. I cancelled it because I will go back to it when everyone else in the group is ready to play. And I'm not saying it's a bad game. I'm not turning my back on it. But so fucking easy to the point where it got boring.
It's boring.
Yeah, it got to the point where I was literally, I went to the HUD editor and I turned off my health bar at one point because it was irrelevant and wasted screen space. It got so easy that it was just insane. It was just insane. And I think maybe that's because I subscribed, and maybe I'm better off not subscribing because it seems to push your XP up too high. But Nusui and anyone else in chat, if you guys want to play that with me, I will happily play that with you. But in all seriousness, think twice. You might actually ruin the game for yourself by subscribing, because it was, I mean, you saw my stream, Sudo. I was literally walking around one-shotting things, like things that looked like they should be a raid. I was just walking into and just pulling a gun. And this was a pistol. I had a bounty hunter. An imperial. I don't know, whatever you call them. Basically, a bounty hunter. And I'm walking around like with like one, like boom, boom, just one shotting everything. And it was insane. It was just boring.
Yeah, you have no sense of satisfaction when it's that easy. Yeah. So why bother?
But bearing in mind, this game uses level blocking. So after, just like Guild Wars 2, when you get to a certain level, it pulls your level down to make sure that it stays a challenge in the area, which is something that I have mixed feelings on anyway, but they have less set it far too high, because even though my level made me about par with the monsters, I say monsters, with the enemies in the area, my gear was still like way above where it should have been, and my pistol was like doing more, like on a bad shot, my pistol was doing more damage than their entire health bar. So, like, even on a bad shot, at one point, I just sort of sat my character down and let my ally do it all. Like, my companion character just do all the shooting.
So it's a clicker.
Yeah, basically, maybe I should resubscribe. But yeah, I'm not saying in any way the game is bad. The game is still great. The story is still strong, and I'll happily play again. I've not uninstalled it. I've keeping it updated. But at the moment, I'm just laying off it for a little bit while everyone else finds time to play it with me. But yeah. Unfortunate when the games happen like that, because I was so happy when I got working in Linux. It was a joyous moment to have it working, and it just sort of fell flat.
Weird when and Ufine Chief who called me Sudodo.
Sudodo, Sudododo, like Mojo Jojo, but with Sudo. So shall we move on to the items of newsy stuff this week, or not newsy stuff this week?
We found interesting, but we're not reporters, so
yeah, we're not. We're barely qualified to read gaming on Linux to you guys, you know.
Barely qualified to read. Leave it at that.
Yeah. So again, first item for gaming on Linux, Star Citizen to use Vulkan instead of DirectX.
Yes.
Which is good, because that basically means that even if they don't release a Linux version, Wine's gonna have you back with this. There's no reason, unless they add some weird like de novo shit to it. The source is looking very good that it's going to be multi-platform because of this. It's looking amazing. And yeah, it all of a sudden makes me excited about Star Citizen again.
So they have come out and said that they are looking to do a Linux build, which I was originally, as soon as they announced that, I became a backer, and then there was nothing for a year or two. So I got refund just to, you know, play it safe in case something happens. The reason I'm excited about this, one, I'm almost certainly going to pick up something like Star Citizen when it releases, but two, they make some points exactly what we've been saying, in that Microsoft is only supporting Windows 10. By using Vulkan, that gives them access to Windows 7, Windows 8, 10, Linux, plus other platforms, and the APIs are about 95% of the same work.
Yep.
So it doesn't make any sense to use DirectX 12 over Vulkan when you get so much more with Vulkan. That's my big win out of all of this.
And Ufine Chief has said it's old news and Star Citizen was confirmed for Linux for years. Yeah, it was confirmed, and then they literally had no progress made at all. Zero progress. And then Valiant Cheese said he, fuck you, Valiant Cheese, with your name dropping and your fucking knowing everybody, with your George Lucas on speed dial and your purple tentacle on the other line. God damn it, why are you so fucking cool? Valiant Cheese said, got my citizenship card off Chris Roberts. You got it signed by Chris Roberts, you know, the guy who's making the game. And we talked about Linux. God damn it. You're Valiant Cheese, you should do this show instead of us, really.
See, do you guys understand why I'm so starstruck that he's here now? Like, he's an important person. We're not shit.
Yeah, we're just dudes with... I'm a dude with a camera. You're not even a dude with a camera, Sudo.
Yeah,
you're
no,
just a disembodied voice. You're a self-important voice. So, yeah. Also, is Chris Roberts a super nice guy? I imagine he'd be a super nice guy. I don't know why.
Seems very nice.
Because every time I see him interviewed, I'm like, yeah, he's made a few mistakes, but he seems like a super nice guy. Yeah. Stuff to talk about next time. You're damn fucking right we're talking about that. And did you also meet, did you ever meet Purple Tentacle? Did you ever meet Purple Tentacle? But a dude with an icon. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
The fact that this is happening, though, and even though Star Citizen was hypothetically confirmed for Linux, they said things like, if the engine ever comes to Linux, we don't see why we wouldn't want to do it. Chris Roberts is the guy that brought us such titles as Wing Commander, and he also was the executive producer or writer on that god-awful Wing Commander film from the 90s, if anyone remembers that.
Didn't he also do Freelancer, though, as well?
He did do Freelancer, yeah, he did Freelancer as well. Yeah. And now he's doing Robert Space Industries, which is Star Citizen, the game. Star Citizen. Yeah, which is, yeah. So, big deal.
So there's a lot of people that are still calling this game Vaporware, something like, you know, Doom, what was it? Duke Nukem Forever.
What? Wolfenstein Forever?
And people are like, they're changing, they're constantly changing game engines. That's not true. Just to put this out there, they were on, what, Unreal Engine 4? Is that what it was? And then Amazon forked it and they have Lumberyard. I definitely know Lumberyard's correct. I don't remember what the original engine was that they forked. But it's literally the same exact engine with AWS hooks. So Amazon Web Service hooks in the back end. That's the only reason they went over that, because they wanted the server side from AWS, and now supporting Vulkan, like, that's already getting built into the engine anyway, again. So it's not like they're making any kind of major changes here.
Yeah, and Cheese makes a valid point here that people say it's vaporware, but you can literally play bits of this game right now. Yeah, you can literally play bits of it now. You can play dogfights and stuff and walk around the area. Like, there's big chunks of the game that are playable. But it's just that main plot line, that single player experience, and the multiplayer greater universe, connected universe. At the moment, it's more complete than most games on Kickstarter, and it's within its time frame as well.
And regardless of your feeling for Star Citizen or not, and let's face it, they've raised, what, $150 million or something from crowdsourcing?
Yep.
We can call them a large developer now. To have a large developer justifying Vulkan is a way better value over something like DirectX 12, in my opinion, is massive and is exactly what we were hoping to see.
Yeah, this is hopefully a taste of things to come. If you've got a game development right now, why wouldn't you want Vulkan? Like, it seems like, why wouldn't you? You know, just of course you do, because why wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Because again, Vulkan allows you to support all the platforms, whereas Microsoft DirectX 12 allows you to support Microsoft DirectX 12 compatible operating systems. I mean, it doesn't even work on fucking XP. I mean, you know, this is the thing.
They're up to 200 million. Holy.
Yeah. Crazy. And 200 million is a tiny budget for the scale of Project G, says. Wow.
It is. Yeah.
Wow. I mean,
well, they're literally trying to build an entire persistent universe that people can live in.
Do you ever worry, right? Do you ever worry that Chris is gonna like raise enough money to simulate the universe, and then one day it'll come out that we're actually the game he's creating, like the whole of the universe is Star Citizen. We're already playing. We're jacked in right now. Do you ever worry about that? Yeah, fucking, I worry about that shit all the time. That shit keeps me awake at night.
Did you take the deep philosophical pills this morning? Because you're on another level today, sir.
I don't know, man. I don't know. It's like I keep going down that rabbit hole today. It's like, whew, done. anyway, we can't say much more about that other than yay.
Yes.
And I found this on Reddit. This is a cool tool that allows you
while
to...
While you're reading Reddit?
Let's not talk about that again. It's in the past. Let's move on from that. But I'd like you to know I had some compliments about that the other day. Yesterday. basically this thing is, it puts a hood up so you can... So when you push a button on your controller, it affects a graphic. So you can put this at the bottom of your stream, and if you're playing a game or a game, it can show what buttons you push in. Which I just thought was, that could be useful. The actual point they designed it for is flight sticks and Xbox controllers. So if you're playing a fighting game, it gives people an idea of what you're doing to make the moves, which is really interesting. But it's one of them ideas that I can't see. I dare say it'd be pretty easy to implement, but no one's done it. And it's just a Python script, and it's just really interesting. So
I find it kind of cool. Like, they actually have a video here.
Yeah, I'm just loading the video now.
Of it in use, and I've actually been seeing more people, Windows players that like to show this, especially with something like a fighter game, where people don't understand that the skill ceiling of these kinds of games, this will blow your mind to see how fast people actually move and the kind of moves. I think it's kind of cool. It's a nice little accessory for your Twitch stream if you play these kind of games.
Yeah, so. Absolutely. And apparently I'm using all the bandwidth right now, so this just isn't loading. But yeah, trust me, it's actually pretty cool. It's actually pretty interesting. But yeah, apparently I'm using all the bandwidth because I know for a fact my daughter's watching Crunchyroll right now because I can hear manga sounds, anime sounds.
Nice.
Yeah. So the next one on the list, because that was just one to little tidbit to look at, is opening up virtual reality development with WebVR. You want to talk about this one?
Yeah, this is who's it? Kronos Group, I believe, is working on. Is it Kronos Group? It's a whole conglomeration of big people that are working on a standard for virtual reality on the web. And because it's working as a standard, Linux will actually, you know, be completely possible. And it's in the very initial stages of it, but I think it's definitely something interesting to keep an eye on. And web, I mean, it definitely seems like developers are very interested in VR, and everyone is kind of calling it dead on arrival, but what they don't understand is
slow process. I think with VR, where it is now is like it shouldn't be public yet. This is like an almost like this is almost being developed in the public because the headsets are kind of like doing most of the job, and then the technology on the computers isn't there. No one knows how to program for it. Like, for real, this is one of those things where like we're seeing it develop, and I think you can't call VR dead for about 5 years. Come back in 5 years and see where it is, because I still think that the future of VR is in mobile phone technology. I don't think it's in headsets. I think it's in mobile phones with attachment devices long term. But yeah, this is all good. There's no downside to this. And at the moment, VR on Linux is kind of sort of a thing, and standards are what we need cross-platform to make it work. So yeah, this is cool, and WebVR's an interesting idea. Visit a website, put a headset on, have an experience, move on. Kind of interesting. Yeah. Kind of interesting idea.
And I'm happy to see that, like, in open source and in standards, we're normally on the back end of the curve.
Yeah.
Like, VR headsets are out now, and it took how long to get Linux support on those? But this is kind of something that VR exists, the web exists, but kind of putting the two together, we're in the initial stages of that. So they're right up front to create this standard to kind of succeed for everyone. Again, it's not just a Linux thing. This is for everyone's betterment. And I mean, Valiant Cheese, his streams, while they're not web VR, like what he's been streaming is actually the HTC Vive, and he's building a little game to learn these things about VR. And I'm not a developer, but he basically got a simple prototype up and working in like one or two streams.
And also,
he shipped his first Linux VR game in 2014, so
ahead of the curve again. Weird Win has mixed feelings about VR. He thinks augmented reality will become integrated to daily life. I absolutely agree with you there. I think augmented reality is going to become so ingrained in daily life that you'll have a pair of glasses like mine, and you'll have like a heads up display floating around you telling you, like, this person's Bob, here's where you first met him, here's what he tells you about his kids, this is how much this thing costs, this is a map of where you are, someone's calling you. I could see all that, but I still think VR has a place for gaming outside of that.
Yes.
And do you remember, if you've got an AR headset, you can simply blinker it and it becomes a VR headset. So the two technologies aren't as mutually exclusive as you think. And holy shit, the Icicle Engine has VR support. That's amazing. So you're looking up, looking down. That's amazing. But I think the two aren't mutually exclusive. I think for gaming, augmented reality only goes so far the way, and you want the full immersive experience that VR offers. So yeah, I think it is a viable technology. And all I want to do with VR, and I've said it before, I just want to fly spaceships. I want to sit here with my HOTAS, and I want to fly spaceships. If that's all I ever do with VR, it's been fucking worth it, because that's all I want out of life is to fly spaceships. In real life as well.
I 100% agree. Yeah. Whether it's AR, VR, PR, I don't care what it is. As long as I could feel like I'm sitting in a spaceship and flying that,
that'd be
amazing.
Yep, absolutely. That's my main goal in life. The next item is kind of just a small one to touch on, is the Linux Gamer released a video, once again, the Let's Gamer, talking about Star Trek New Horizons, Stellaris Total Conversion mod. So this is a total conversion that takes Stellaris and it makes it Star Wars skinned. Makes it Star Trek skin. I keep saying Star Wars instead of Trek. Is that Freudian, do you think?
Star Trek. Star Trek!
Wow, that's Freudian as fuck. I like Next Gen. Next Gen was cool.
Star Trek is greater than Star Wars, sir. Let's get into that argument.
They're both great in their own way, and they're for different tastes. It's fine.
So if anyone is wondering what this has to do with Linux, the Linux Gamer did a video. That's my justification for this.
And but Stellaris was a day one Linux release. It's a great game.
Yes, it was. Yeah. And Stellaris is amazing. And if I can get Star Trek in Stellaris, like, I'm going to be blown away. I just want to let people know that this is out there. The Linux Gamer does a great job showing it working, but points out that there's still a massive amount of work to do.
Yeah.
So don't like drop this in and think it's going to work. There's still work, but like, I'm just very excited about this because my love of Stellaris is incredible, even though I don't get to play it all that much. And Star Trek, I mean, the one thing that I'll say of Star Trek over Star Wars is Star Trek is us in the future. We have succeeded.
No, it's not. Star Wars is us in the future. I'm going to be a fucking Jedi and wear a dressing gown everywhere I go. That's the future
for me. It happened in a galaxy far, far away a long time ago, Hex.
Yeah, last Wednesday, and it was at the end of my drive. And also, you find she said I might want to check out the upcoming X Rebirth VR edition. Oh, don't worry. Don't worry. Yeah. I will be.
Oh, I totally would.
I don't have a headset right now, but I'm going to take a monitor, tape it to my head, and just like, then it'll be like the same thing, I think. That's what I'm going to do. But yeah, I'm waiting for the OSVR headsets to drop in price. OSVR headsets will be fine. We want
I just
want
to see you tape a monitor to your head and be like, I'm in VR.
Yeah, I've got big fucking monitors too, so that's going to be a problem, isn't it? My plague, Star Wars is swashbuckling in space, whereas Star Trek is science fiction. I don't think it matters. I think as long as it's entertaining, who gives a shit either way? But Babylon 5 rules them all. Moving on.
Never seen it.
Babylon 5 is so good. Babylon 5 is worth the attention. This is a tangent. This is the tangent cast today, isn't it? Jesus Christ! RPG Maker MV is out for Linux. That's the newest iteration of RPG Maker. It's not just out for Linux, but you can export Linux applications. You can make a Linux game in this, and that to me is quite exciting because of all the game makers out there, RPG Maker is one of the most accessible, and it allows you to do lots of interesting stuff. I mean, like, even though people can say that's an RPG Maker game, I've played some shit that looks amazing that's been built in RPG Maker because they've put the time and effort in. But the whole tool suite is now available for Linux. And that's pretty cool. And the moment it goes on sale, Hex is going to be buying this, but I'm not paying the full price for it because it's insane.
It shows, $80 American.
Yeah, I'm just going to check what actually it is. RPG Maker MV. It is £60.99 for the UK. Which is quite a lot of money. And I'm not saying it's not worth it. It probably is absolutely worth it. And I have no doubt I would get that much value out of it. I also don't have £60 spare to pay on an RPG Maker, you know? So that's my point.
I'm looking at it this way. It's an investment for the future millions you're going to make off of RPG Maker MV.
Yeah, when I make Hex's Life Simulator, absolutely. I have no doubt it's great, and I think it's wonderful to see it on Linux because this is something that I have no doubt when I finally get it, will use the shit out of it. And I think a lot of other people who are more creative, talented, and skilled than me could make a game in RPG Maker that we'll end up buying on Steam and thinking is amazing. So yeah, all in all, I have love for RPG Maker. It's cool, and I like the fact it's on Linux. Fucking finally, is what I'd like to say there.
I mean, let's be honest. If PewDiePie can make a game, we need a Hex DSL game out there.
Yeah, and I would make a damn sight better game than that. I'd make a game with robots and...
Game's awful.
I want robots. I want bows and arrows because I think they look fucking awesome, especially when you get like a bow and you pull the bow back and there's like a rocket on the end of it. That's what we want, right? We need bows and arrows. We need spaceships. None of this fantasy bullshit. Too much of this fantasy bullshit. And we need something with a racing car because racing cars are awesome. Done. Already better than PewDiePie's game. Already. And I went off on a massive tangent there. So let's move on. But yeah, I don't think anyone... Does anyone in here already use RPG Maker? Is it something that people like? Or is it just me that thinks it's pretty awesome? No? Okay. No. Okay. And the next item is... Oh, this is from the Boiling Steam website. This is an interesting website. I've not been that much of a big reader of it until recently. But yeah, there's actually some pretty good articles on here. And this is the Wine Revolution article, which Pseudo found. And this is a list of all the cool shit that wine's doing. And it's very much worth reading.
Yeah, it's a really good little article going over, you know, how far we've come. And showing in there the different big games that are now functioning decently in wine. And it kind of gives a video and an overview of Witcher 3, GTA 5, and Overwatch. Now, this was...
That's DJ's video, by the way. The Overwatch video here.
DJ's video. It is. Yeah. This came out on the 15th, so it's a bit old because apparently Overwatch is now broken once again in wine, but they know how to fix it. It's just going to take some time to fix it. And so Boiling Steam is actually a really good website as well. And we have the creator of Boiling Steam in our Linux group as well.
Yay! The least the creator could do is watch X Penguin and come and put in chat like Jesus did, you know? That'd be great. But all in all, it's pretty cool. I didn't actually know Witcher 3 was doing that well in wine actually either, so that's interesting.
Yeah, he breaks it down and says, I mean, I don't think he did the testing on it, but someone on an i7 4770 with an RX 480 at 1920x1200 at ultra high settings was getting 45 frames per second.
That's pretty cool.
That is playable.
I might have to actually check that out and see how it goes, because that's interesting. And Witcher 3 is a really good game. There's no rocket launchers on the bows and arrows, but other than that, it's a really cool game, you know? And apparently GTA 5 is also working as well. It's pretty cool.
Boiling Steam did a Valiant Cheese interview about the Day of the Tentacle Port.
Interesting. Also, Valiant Cheese, I noticed your article on Gaming on Linux. Don't think I didn't see that.
Yeah, I saw that as well. That was really good.
I'd already read it all because you'd already linked me directly to the original article, but, you know, it's still cool to see. Because I scrolled down, I was like, I've seen that before. And I was like, oh, that's interesting. Then I realized that you actually wrote the article, and I was like, oh, okay, I've probably read this then. But, yeah, cool stuff. The next item is... an on-disk cache is coming to the RadV Vulkan driver. Do you want to LE5 us on that one? Pseudo.
Vulkan's getting better.
Okay, that it? Is that what we say? Is that it?
So, well, I've been trying to figure these things out. This stuff is really technical. And actually, Cheese the other day was explaining to me what shaders were. They're basically just little programs that can be run on the graphics card themselves. Like I had never idea what a shader was, but it's just like a little script that kind of manages certain things for you. So what, from my understanding of this, what this is doing is basically if you don't want to manage certain things in your engine or in your game, then that's okay, because RadV, which is the open source Vulkan driver at this time, is basically taking over more of that work for you, making it easier for a developer to develop for things like that.
Yeah.
I just pulled a muscle on my leg. Good Lord.
Wow. was that like how powerful this news is? It pulled a muscle in your leg. So yeah, anything that makes Vulkan better, especially on open source drivers, is amazing. Because again, one day, open source system. It's the way to go. It's what we all want, I think.
It's coming.
It's coming. It is actually coming, isn't it? It really is coming. It really is happening as well. It seems to be, which is cool, especially considering that that we'll get to the next item anyway. Gremlins Inc. is open here. Why is Gremlins Inc. open here? Oh, okay. Carry on.
The next three articles are just statistics that I found interesting through the web. So this article is about a game called Gremlins Inc., and this is only about people that purchased this game. So take that with a grain of salt. But they break down, you know, so many people bought the game and DLC and in-game items. And they were from, you know, these different countries, Russia, US, China. But the one thing that I found interesting, which was kind of disheartening, they break down like OS usage, which is, you know, we're right where we expect to be, 1%. But then the platforms, they break it down from country and the platform type. So Windows, Mac, and Linux, US, Russia, worldwide, we're all at 1%. Makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
The one area that I always thought would really take off, would really, Linux would like blow up, would be something like, I don't want to, big countries that don't exactly have the means or aren't interested in running Windows. China, for instance, would be a very largest country in the world. And you would think that they'd want to keep something like Windows out because of all of the issues with privacy and whatnot.
And the Americas.
This is the Americas. And this clearly shows that Linux usage in China is not 1%, it is 0.1%.
Yeah, so in a country where logically you would think China is pro-open source and they sort of are trying to move away from imported products like American products like Windows, you would think that in a country like that, the zeitgeist would be trending towards non-Microsoft platforms, even non-Apple platforms. So you would have expected Linux to be at 1.5, 1.6% rather than the 1%. But instead it went the other way, which I'm wondering if it might be more relevant to the restrictions in purchasing things in China, to be honest, than it is down to the actual operating system usage. So again, very minor like group. It's like, it's interesting that this company have put out this information and it is about one game. So like, that could literally be two sales. Yeah. Like, we don't know how many sales that breaks down to.
Yeah, and there, well, I mean, it. No, if you scroll up, it shows, like, in comparison, how many. So Russia came first, US came second, China came third, and then a whole bunch of other countries after that. So they're not, their sales aren't far off of what the US's were, but yet there was a massive, difference in platform breakdown, which, I'm just kind of hoping that, you know, they turn it around and see that there's value in something like Linux. And someone did point it out, supposedly in China, there's like 95% of the Windows versions out there are pirated. That's true, but you'd like, I just don't get why they would want to go with something like a fully American made product, even if you've hacked it, instead of something like Linux.
And but, also another question would be, was this game even popular in China? Was it localized in China? Because there's lots of other questions. There's too many variables for this to be serious, but it puts a question in my mind. So even though there's so many variables and so many questions to ask about the game to see if it was even popular over there, I still think if this is five sales, that, you know, if it's a very minor number of sales, then it's one thing. But if it's sold really well, it's different.
Yeah.
I would say, though, I would like to see other instances of numbers like this, because I wonder if the usage in China is less, or is it more, or is there just less people playing games in China? There's lots of, you know, there's lots of questions to ask. Perhaps, like, socially, Windows is just seen as a gaming platform, but Linux is seen as work. You know, so, like, they could have a 95% coverage, but if people don't perceive Linux as a gaming platform over there, then obviously you've got, you know, the same thing. So there are lots of questions to ask. Very interesting. But, yeah, it does raise more questions than it actually answers, I think.
Yeah, and I just found it to be an interesting statistic to talk about. And Jesus is right. You can't really judge something like this based off the fact of one title, because there are so many variables. It was just interesting to see, you know, the developer. A lot of developers don't want to be upfront about stuff like this. It's good to see that they give us that. And it's just a little bit disheartening about the 0.1% in China. But we have some other statistics that were the one specifically I really enjoyed.
So Linux Gamer Survey on Boiling Steam.
Oh, that's a good one. Okay. That's the next one in that. Now everyone needs to take this with a grain of salt as well, because Boiling Steam is specifically a Linux website, I believe. I believe they're a Linux focused website. So like when they do the study, it shows like what kind of operating system do you use at home? 99% run Linux. So I would definitely say this is a Linux website, but there's a lot of really interesting, if you guys like statistics, I don't know. There's a lot of really interesting information in this that breaks it down. Like Ubuntu's still first, but Arch is like right on its heels.
Yeah, Arch is gaining. Arch-based distros are going to overtake Ubuntu at some point. I just think that seems like the way it's going. I don't think it'll be Arch Pure, but I think Arch-based distros will take over, which is a whole separate topic, really. But yeah, there's a lot of numbers here, aren't there? If you like numbers, this is a good page. There's lots of graphs and things.
The one thing that I'm actually very surprised about is GPU usage. NVIDIA has 70%, while AMD has 23. I actually expected that to be a lot lower for AMD. So good on AMD.
It's interesting. That falls. That doesn't surprise me. That falls in line with what I'd expect. But
really?
Yeah, because I think a lot of people I talk to in the chat group in the Linux Gamer group we've got, a lot of people I talk to, they run AMD. And a lot of people who don't primarily game run AMD. I know for the people who consider themselves to be more serious gamers, most of us run NVIDIA because it's an easy ride. But yeah, a lot of people I encounter do run AMD, and especially people that have come from Windows. Because if you're on a Windows machine, it doesn't really matter. You buy whatever one's best for your money. And then you come to Linux, all of a sudden you go, should have bought Intel, you know? But a lot of people that are switching over from one operating system to another will bring AMD with them. So I think that's probably where that comes from.
Yep.
Yeah.
Lots of great stuff. It doesn't surprise anyone, I'm sure, that Steam is by far the most used website. But I highly recommend everyone give this a check because there's some really good statistics in here. Again, it's from one community.
Yep.
It's based on Linux, so you know, don't keep your reality in check as far as that goes.
In fact, that's a good piece of advice for any website showing you graphs or numbers. Take it with a big old helping of salt and doubt. Apart from Pornhub, whose numbers are accurate because they have no agenda other than to make you happy and relaxed and in need of a shower. The next item is the Stack Overflow item. The Stack Overflow item that you've linked to platform. Oh, the link takes me straight to the platform section.
It takes you straight to platforms.
So do you want to explain this again while I like model it?
Yeah. So for those that don't know what Stack Overflow is, Stack Overflow is a website that prides themselves like helping developers to code, and they have an amazing community. They're huge. They're probably one of the websites to go to if you need help coding, and they also do.
As someone who spends way more time in Microsoft Excel than is necessary because it's kind of what I do for a living, I get a lot of really useful nuggets of information from Stack Overflow. So many useful nuggets. Good for them.
It's great. Even as a sysadmin, when I was a sysadmin, I was constantly finding things on Stack Overflow that were of use to me.
Yep.
So they do statistics as well. They basically ask everyone to, if you have an account, they ask you, you know, to fill out a survey and go through it. The thing that I was super excited about was this platform's one.
Yep, I'm on that now.
Windows Desktop is number one. However, number two, excuse me, I'm getting awful clumped. Number two is Linux by 33%.
Yep. So like this is Stack Overflow's audience are smart dudes, developers, people interested in code and tinkering. So then again, numbers are skewed. But yeah, we're literally like coming at Windows hard on this particular graph, which is interesting.
So yeah, of all of their developers, this isn't saying that 32% use Linux only and 41 is Windows. It's do you run Linux as one of your platforms? So you can have multiple, you know, one developer can run multiple machines, but 33% of people that answer this, and it was a massive amount of people, like over 100,000 or something like that. I can't remember the full numbers. 33% of developers run Linux. Mm-hmm. That's huge. And the next one, if you scroll down to the most loved, dreaded, and wanted, you have to do some scrolling to find it.
Yeah, I got it right here. Yeah.
The most loved platform by far was Linux.
Wait, where are you seeing that? I'm looking at most loved, dreaded, and wanted. I got Rust, Smalltalk.
I'm looking for Linux. Keep going down. Most loved, dreaded, and wanted platforms. Wow. Linux is 70%, where something, you know, desktops, the next desktop is 62%. And Microsoft is like 56.
Wow, look at that. I mean, for those watching the stream, look, I'm highlighting Windows there. And then Linux is way up at the top. Developers love their Linux. That's fair to say. And you know what? the code goes where the developers go. So if you've got developers loving Linux, they're writing code for Linux, which means that it only makes us better, doesn't it?
And it, you know, the way that I've been looking at it recently to try and keep my, because I want Linux to be the desktop, right?
Yeah, you've got an agenda.
We've won everywhere else. The way I look at it is when you get those developers, those guys running, loving Linux, they're going to want to keep coming back to Linux and seeing, is this the viable way for me to run my job and my business now on a day-to-day basis? The more times you have them loving that, the more they want to help out with something like that, the more likely when a family member calls them up and says, hey, what should I use? They're going to recommend something like Linux. I see this all kind of, and again, I have an agenda, so I'm going to see it in a positive light, but.
But Jesus has asked where Linux sits on the dreaded and wanted tabs. Well, on the dreaded tab, it sits at the bottom, so it's only 30% dreaded. And on wanted, Linux is, I'm not seeing it on the list. Android, Raspberry, oh, Linux, there you go. 9.6% on the wanted list. So that's interesting. Interesting stuff.
Well, that's yeah. How many, I think the wanted is those developers that wanted to work on that platform. So Android, for obvious reasons, mobile is huge. AWS is a great one too, because you can hit all of the server side stuff. Pi, actually, that's kind of interesting that the Raspberry Pi is 15%.
Yeah.
iOS, again, another mobile thing, but when you consider desktop, it is by far the highest desktop out of all of them. So yep. I'm still, yeah, SharePoint's the most dreaded.
Yep, that's fair. Windows Phone's not as high up as I expected on dreaded, though. It's fourth. I thought it would have been like two or three at absolute worst. That's interesting. This is a great article. Very interesting stuff. And it's nice to see numbers with larger sample sizes than people who bought Gremlins Inc. So, you know, there's that. There's that, if we're honest, isn't there? Next item is, this is where my bandwidth is going. This video has been playing for the last 36 minutes. Okay, so that's where my bandwidth is all gone. This is Vulkan game development on mobile. This is a YouTube video talking about developing Vulkan on mobile. Do you have anything to say on this one, or are we just pointing at it?
It's not. So what I wanted to do is make people aware that this is, the Kronos Group actually has, so for those that don't know, the Kronos Group is a standards group that have been working on Vulkan. So Vulkan, again, is the graphics API that's in direct competition with something like DirectX 12. Well, Kronos Group did a lot of talks at the Game Developers Conference, all about how do you program for Vulkan, and you know the benefits of it, Vulkan on mobile, on the desktop deep dive, all of these new things that are coming out, such as the web VR and stuff like that. This link isn't specifically pointing out this one video, but there's an entire playlist of videos that I watch some of them, and they get really hardcore into some of the technical stuff, but it shows you where they want to take this technology in the future. And again, if you're interested in the technological side of this kind of stuff, go watch these videos. There's a lot of really good content in these.
Yep, definitely. This is this playlist ends with NVIDIA demo Vulkan GDC 2017. That one I have already seen. There's a lot of cool stuff here. Talking about WebGL, which Web Vulkan seems like a good idea as well. You know, WebGL with all these web technologies. Seems like a lot of developers are really interested in web technology at the minute, like graphics technology on the web. I think most people's connections are just at the point where they're fast enough to actually handle this properly. That's interesting.
And I think in one of these, they discuss their other layer of graphics that they're talking about. So for those that don't know right now, you have something like Vulkan and DirectX, and then on Apple, you have Metal, because obviously Apple has to be different.
Yep.
So one thing that Kronos is doing is actually building another layer that sits on top of that. So all games can target that layer, and then that layer will then translate to Vulkan or to DirectX or to Metal. And again, Vulkan and DirectX are supposedly about 95% the same.
Yeah, Also, Cheeson says he misses when browsers were for web pages and other apps were for applications. Man, I miss the days when we didn't have the fucking word app. Jesus Christ, this word app. It's everywhere. You can't escape it. Fucking applications. God damn, sorry. Anyway, carry on.
I absolutely love New Series Metal, though, with the little
Metal!
That's an awesome emoticon. I've never seen that before. Yeah, that's really good.
Okay, so yeah, that's a good watch, and there's an awful lot of hours there. You're gonna waste like hours, content. Hours. I wish YouTube would tell you how long the playlist is. That'd be cool. App can get in the sea. Yeah, okay, fair enough. And the next item is Qemu. Is that how you say it? Qemu is Qemu. The Qemu sounds nice. Is interested in Vulkan guest support for Vulkanized VIRGL. Do you want to explain this? Because
So the Qemu group is actually looking for an intern to for the summer outreach program to implement this. But what they're looking at is they want to enable 3D rendering in a VM using Vulkan. So they'll implement Vulkan accelerated rendering. So this will make your VMs run probably amazingly better.
Right. Because if they do this, if they get this, I mean, like Qemu, I don't know how we say this. Qemu is already a great way to deliver ISOs and to deliver pre-built virtualized experiences. I could see Qemu becoming the standard in virtual machines, because I think if they're using Vulkan throughout the entire graphics stack, you could probably game on this better than VMware. Like, I could see like this actually being usable with what we've seen from Vulkan already. But yeah, that's cool. I mean, either way, that's pretty cool that they're even doing this, because Qemu is one of the projects that sort of gets forgotten, doesn't it?
And I'm just absolutely amazed by how much. I mean, I was never surprised at how much you've been talking about Vulkan for gaming, but for how many other things that people want to implement Vulkan for. I mean, heck, was it GTK wants to do Vulkan specifically for Renderer now?
It's a really good idea.
Like, everything is going Vulkan. And Cheese, it's interesting you say that. So Cheese says that he predicted that people would use abstraction layers that gave higher level OpenGL functionality rather than using Vulkan directly. Mm-hmm. And we kind of talked about that originally with game engines, like your game engine will
just export
abstract
Vulkan.
That out for
you. Yeah.
Yeah. We've been seeing that there have been layers added on top of that. I don't know if you want to talk about this now, but
yeah,
Anvil.
Which Anvil. Yeah, there you go, Anvil. It's
on
the screen.
So this is one of many topics we've been hearing lately about adding abstraction layers, adding coding wrappers, whatever you want to call it, so that more developers can program in their native language directly for Vulkan. So Anvil was just announced this week by AMD.
Finally, they did something.
Yeah, it's so weird. It's very torn about this because GPU Open is AMD's open source site. For AMD is like, we're open sourcing all the things. Here it is on GPU Open.
Yeah.
But yet they still haven't.
Go on then, AMD. Go on then. You've got the website. Just do the work.
Yeah, they haven't fully open sourced their driver. They haven't open sourced their Vulkan driver yet. But then they're like, here you go. Here's this new Anvil framework that allows you to code in C++ for Vulkan.
It's like, yay.
You're going off with that first. Why don't you give us the core technologies and then worry about the accessories later? I mean, it's great to see again that there's so many different projects going right now for people to code in their native language to get Vulkan support. But give us the Vulkan driver
The fucking drivers, AMD.
So.
Yeah, because like, I really think AMD could be the number one in Linux overnight, but just going, here's all the open source. We did it. There you go. Then I'd rush out. I'd go out today and buy an AMD card if that happened. Just no doubt whatsoever. So really, they want the market share. They can have it. They can get it, you know?
Well, and that's... So I think what Weirdwin says, pandering to management, I think it's more pandering to the public. Like, you guys said you're going to open source your stuff, so where is it? And they're like, oh, here. You know, you wanted a car? Here you go. Here's a Bolt. What? It's like, okay, where's the rest of it? Like, you guys... We want to love you. You announce something that's absolutely amazing that hasn't been done before. We want to support you, but you need to show up to the party, man.
But that is AMD doing a lot of talking and not very much work. That's what they do. You know? That's kind of AMD, isn't it?
Yeah. But, and I mean, in all fairness, they did fully... So those that don't know, Vulkan was actually an in-house project to AMD called Mantle, and AMD gave it to the Kronos group to turn into Vulkan.
Yeah, and they did wondrous things with it.
Yeah, they're doing great stuff with it. And it's like, okay, now give us the rest of the stuff that you said you were going to give us. Like,
Do better, you bastards. It's
like they're having multiple personality syndrome.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, one side says we want to do it, and then the next side's like, we never said we're doing that.
I'd like to think that AMD is a beast with two heads that's like, we will open source, we will not open source. And also, on a side note, Nusui has just pointed out that the game we talked about a couple of weeks ago, I don't remember if Pseudo Shred was here for this because it's been ages. Heartbound, was you here for the Heartbound talk? No?
Was I here for the Heartbound? Heartbound sounds familiar.
Like, Heartbound was the game that looked a bit like Undertale, but was being on Kickstarter. It looked really good, and they had a Linux demo available. A beta, they called it. It was a demo. They've been funded at 19,272. Of their goal of 5,000. So you can say they was funded to the moon, I think. So yeah, good for them. Good for them.
And Glog posted an article in here about VKCPP, which I believe we've discussed before. Kronos Group's C++ wrapper.
Thing, yeah.
So now we have multiple. So we have Anvil and we have Kronos Groups, and there was another one we talked about. Was it Python?
Yeah. Well, there was a Python thing, and there was also something I can't remember. We've talked about loads of them at this point.
So yeah.
But yeah, but I think as long as they work, who gives a shit? Just pick the one you like the best and use it. The end result is still Vulkan, so it's fine. I think.
Yeah.
That's how I feel.
And I mean, Mindplague says AM will be. So he's saying that, you know, they'll get there. But you have to give them a year or two. They're much smaller than NVIDIA and Intel. But that's the point that we're trying to make is, or at least
they don't have
to
be.
They don't have to be. Yeah. You can, by open sourcing your stuff, you have now literally have the world to help you write for your thing. So you go from this small underdog to, hey, does anyone want to come contribute? And I guarantee you there are people that want to come contribute to that.
Yep. Absolutely. No. And moving back to the topics then, we have, Unreal Engine 4 making progress on Linux with Vulkan and Steam VR.
And yeah, Valiant Cheese, I saw that face. That hex. He always does that.
What, my who face?
Yeah, whoops, I hit the wrong button and I'm going to the wrong screen now.
Yeah, no one saw that cheesiness. Yeah, it's fine. No one, thanks for, if you hadn't blown it for me, nobody, I went to the, do you have any idea how much shit I've got open right now? It's a lot of shit I've got open right now. This show is actually much more difficult to manage than you think. I have to change scenes, get the fucking web pages up. I've got another browser with the show notes in. It's hard work, dude. It's hard work.
Yeah.
And sometimes I accidentally roll the intro.
He's done that. Yeah,
I've done that multiple times. But yeah, this is pretty cool. Unreal Engine for making progress on Linux with Vulkan. That's just, pretty cool. Not a lot else we can say about that, is there really? There's a video on the page that I linked.
I mean, I was excited about this one because Unreal Engine 4 on Linux, which, yes, it has been there, but you know, they open source that, so a lot of people have been doing it. But seeing again what the inroads that are being made for stuff like, you know, game engines on Linux is amazing. With Vulkan, yes, another win, and Steam VR. And this is, I think this is another great win for us on where it's going. Now, Cheese, when he's doing his VR stuff, I want to say he's been doing it in Unity, and it seems to work incredibly well.
Can we just interact with Cheese? Cheese says he's got 354 tabs open. That seems reasonable to Hex. That's actually not out of the ordinary. That seems fine. That's in my ballpark. What web browser are you using, Cheese? With that many tabs, does Firefox take it, or are you on Chromium like I am? Because I found that Firefox shits itself after about 60 tabs. So I'd be interested to see what
that is. I would never do that. I have 4 tabs open
right now. Why would you close anything? If you've got 16 gig of RAM, fucking use it. It's what it's for.
No.
The worst one is, though, when your browser crashes and you've got like 100 tabs open and you reopen it and the tabs aren't there and you're going, I didn't bookmark anything.
Yeah.
Five with 354 tabs in one of 5 windows. Okay. Firefox, really? I have major problems with Firefox in that many tabs. I wonder if my desktop environment, we'll have to talk on this another time.
So of those 5 tabs, he has over 60 tabs open on each of them.
Seems fine to me.
That would only be 300. And for those that don't know, Firefox has a separate thread for each Firefox open.
Yeah, so you can.
I believe.
Yeah.
It's completely separate PID, whereas something like Chrome, every single tab is a separate PID.
Which is why it works better, yeah.
Yeah.
So, if you've got 500 tabs open, you've got 500 instances of Firefox loaded, which is quite a memory hog. Yeah, it's ridiculous. Anyway.
So I can't actually get this video to load. I don't know if you got it to load, but this shows you the work that they've made in Unreal Engine, on Linux, with Vulkan and SteamVR. All wins.
Yep, no downside there. My quality is very low because of using all the bandwidth at the moment. Pretty cool. Pretty cool stuff. It's one of those things where I'm still at the point where I really want to get excited about all this stuff, but until I've got a VR headset, I'm like, this is theoretically awesome, but I don't have anything to actually give a shit with. So yeah, that's where I am with this. But OSVR, I'm looking at OSVR headsets. Sooner or later, you'll come down in price and I'll have one, because that's the headset I want rather than anything else, because it's open source and that's cool. Hackable hardware. Yay. Anyway, that's pretty cool. So let's move on to the next one. Gaming on Linux article, we want to point out, that says interview with Feral Interactive about their ports and Mesa drivers. Mm-hmm. Steam keys offered for Mesa developers. So that's pretty interesting, isn't it? This article is written by, Liam. Yeah, Liam wrote it himself. And he's interviewing with a few of the guys, including Edwin and Mark. There you go.
It's a great interview. Go read it. The big thing that stood out to me was that Feral, for those that don't know Feral, they're one of the big, really good game porters we have on Linux.
Yep.
And what they did was they basically said, okay, guys, over the last, I think it was 2 years, anyone that contributed 25 commits or more over like something like the last 2 or 3 years, something like that, you guys now get access to all of our games. And this to me just shows it's the gratitude, but also the forward thinkingness of someone like Feral, because, you know, you're saying thank you to the guys that have done so much great work to help your games work on free and open source drivers, but also it gets people excited.
Yeah, they want to work.
I want to be one of those people.
And they want to go. They want to go. Like, I was going to commit a little bit, but look at all the cool shit they gave me. I spent 50 hours playing XCOM. Now I really want to make this work better, because they've got the games that they're trying to make work on these platforms. So they're more invested in the project. So yeah, it's really forward thinking. It's pretty much what Valve did when they first came to Linux, where they gave all the Debian guys the entire Valve catalog. Like, just there you go, which is pretty cool. It was because it's a nice gesture, it's good PR, and it genuinely creates a developer base for your games. Genuinely. And this article is really fucking long. I've just realized how long this is scrolling down. Wow. Really?
Yeah, it's pretty good. Liam, I mean, we always, you know, give Liam a good pat on the back. He does good stuff. I enjoy his interviews. And there's someone just did a really long article, something about Star Wars. Do you know what that's about? I don't remember the name.
Yeah, this cheesy looking fella did a Star Wars post that I've already linked in chat, so he's not getting any more free press, god damn it. But yeah, it's all good stuff, and this article is it's a really fucking long. This is really long, so there's probably all sorts of morsels in there that we haven't really talked about in our cursory hit. But yeah, and cards on the table, guys, I do a podcast with Liam once a month called Counts of Linux Gamers, so we have to be honest, we can't be that objective. So, you know, we can't be that big, can we? No, so yeah, there's that. Anyway, moving on to the next one, which is another Gaming Analytics article. This is interesting. I have actually read this one in its entirety more than once. You will want to force your CPU into high performance mode for Vulkan games on Linux. This is talking about the power saving stuff that Linux uses. Like, you know, most people are aware of this because of laptops, where you can change your scaler. You can go from you can change it from power save to performance to like low power mode. And default, this is just on power save for Intel CPUs. And by default, it's fine on that, because when it's not using power, it doesn't. And then it'll kick itself into high gear when it's needed. But there's some people are talking certain models of CPU, for instance. A lot of AMD CPUs benefit from you manually changing the scaler to something a little bit more power hungry rather than relying on the automated function. To be clear, does not make your CPU faster, but puts it in the best state for playing games right from the start, so you won't get the whole loading stutter and stuff in theory.
Yeah, it sounds incredibly interesting. I was very interested when I heard about this. So for those that don't know, Vulkan kind of so normally in your machine, you'll have, say, like four CPUs. Okay, well, there's a little guy in there, not a guy, but just to make it easy, there's a little guy in there that basically turns up the level if you need more power in any one of those, and then turns it back
more power.
Yeah, so he turns it up to 11 when you need it.
Yeah.
What was found was Vulkan, because it hyper threads, it goes across all of those threads to use them better, to be more performant, that as they're trying to beef up, say, in threads 3 or 4 or whatever, that guy is like, oh, I don't see anything being done on thread 3, so I'm going to turn it down right as Vulkan's kicking up. And then he's like, no, you can't run that high. You got to stay lower. So basically what this does is this overrides him and says, no, give me full power all the time,
more power,
so that Vulkan can be as performant as possible.
Yeah.
Yeah, one little happy penguin's in there.
It's actually this guy that's doing it. This is the guy in your CPU that's doing it, for anyone that's interested. this is the little fella that's doing it. He's in your CPU right now, cranking your cores, messing with your shit, and making sure everything works. The guy to blame. I tried it. I had a little fiddle with it. Didn't make a scrap of difference on my system. Not even a little bit. No difference.
How old your system?
I've got an i7-3770 and a GTX 970.
Yeah, so you're talking. Okay, but this doesn't have to do with the card. So this is just for your CPU.
Yeah.
So your 3770 is, four generations old now?
Yeah, probably. Yeah, probably. About that. Yeah, something like that. It's probably already cranking out a max anyway.
I'm not saying you're going to go from 1 FPS to 100 FPS, but this is just something to be of note. I would like to see the benchmarks. If someone like Michael Larrabell wasn't aware of this and it could have been impacting his stuff, I would like to see his benchmarks reset with something like this taken into account.
I don't know how much it'll take into account, because once the game's loaded and everything's in full swing, I would have thought it would have made a massive amount of difference. I would think this would affect the early portion of the game loading and everything ramping up. I would have thought that would be the point where it affected the most. Because the game load is going to even out. Like, once you've been playing for 20 minutes, the game load is going to be even. So I would have thought the scaler would find a level and stay there. I wouldn't have thought it would be going up and down that fast. So I don't know. Maybe I'm misunderstanding this, but I would have thought, for the early load, definitely worth the difference. In theory, anyway. I can see why they say that. But it's not the first time I've seen people talk about scalers in Linux. I know there was a lot of hoop ha a couple of years ago when people were saying that the way Linux distributes work to different to multi-threads through the hyper-threads, do Intel call it? I know there was one point people saying that wasn't as efficient as it could be, the timings was off, so a lot of people were messing with stuff there. So I don't know if that's been resolved kernel side now, but it's not the first time I've heard of this sort of thing affecting performance anyway, is what I'm trying to say.
Yep.
And apparently Michael Larrabell's already approached this years ago, apparently. Yeah.
But what's he having said to in Vulkan?
Yeah.
Was it done years ago with Vulkan in mind?
Maybe he's always done it. Maybe he sets them all to maximum, balls in the wind.
You can leave your governor on power, or not power savings. It's whatever the highest, most performant one is, but still. Anyway.
Yeah. Interesting stuff. Next one is Bazookas, the OBS Linux browser thing, which is pretty interesting. This is a plugin for OBS, which someone who streams, we actually met this guy streaming, well, you met this guy streaming, he was in one of my streams last night. Was it last night? Yeah, it was last night. Well, yesterday, wasn't it? Anyway, he's the guy that makes the WebKit chat thing, the WebKit, I don't know what the word, WebKit plugin OBS, for OBS.
OBS, QT, WebKit.
Yeah, is it a plugin? Do we describe it as a plugin or a source?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, it's definitely a plugin. It's what when Hex got followers earlier and it pops up with nothing in the background, this is what allows him to do that with the OBS QT WebKit.
Yeah, which is pretty cool because it renders just the text to the background. Oh, there you go. Wow. yeah, that was like almost supernatural. Has he been here the whole time hanging out, waiting for this moment? Or has he like been summoned by Nisui? Because okay. Okay, that's pretty cool. So yeah, this is the chat. This is the guy that's made this. The version of WebKit he's given us already is what I've been using with no problems for like at least what 8 months now, something like that. So the new version apparently allows the loading of Flash, which obviously we all love Flash, and it's based on a more recent renderer. So in theory, we'll have less issues.
Which is Chromium.
Yeah, I haven't tried this yet because, again, I never change anything before a show. So I found out about this yesterday and I haven't had a chance to try it because I refuse to do anything that could break it before a show because that'd be stupid. But I will be looking at this. I will be looking at this tonight, probably mess with this tonight. And hopefully I'll be on it by the time we're on the next show. I'll be on this version, which is interesting. But yeah, all this stuff you're seeing here right now on the screen, the chat box, is all powered by Bazooka's work. So yeah.
So
good work, Bazooka.
So I believe this newer one will have HTML5 support. He said Flash. I don't know how many of us is going to do it. But guys, again, it's on GitHub. Help him out. If you see a bug or have something for him, help him out. Bazookas is an awesome guy. He's been streaming. He was one of the first Linux streamers I had ever seen on Twitch outside of Shadow Sagan. Really cool guy. Go stop and talk to him. But for any of those that are streaming as well, the other one's deprecated. So check this out.
Definitely. I don't know how easy it is to install. I assume it's just drop it in the folder and OBS detects it, I assume.
I haven't done it. Well, I mean, it's sourced from GitHub, so you'd have to build it. But I've always done the AUR, and I'm sure it's in the AUR.
Bazookin, if you want to make an AUR package, Bazookin, I wouldn't mind that. That'd be okay, Bazookin. I'm just saying, Bazookin, if you wanna make the AUR version of it, that'd be fine too. Okay. So yeah, thank you very much to Bazooka for your work anyway. We do appreciate you, and apparently unbeknowingly I've been using your work every time I stream without knowing who to thank, so that's cool. And everyone go subscribe to his stream and watch him. Yay. What I'd love to find this in the AUR because I'm lazy. Yes, Nisui, maybe we should bother Bazooka, who might be able to tell us if it's there or not. Now here we go for the most important item of news on the show is the XFCE bug that is wrecking people's monitors. So if you're using XFCE, this potentially is actually causing physical damage to your monitor, which I think is a very valid point that's well worth talking about. The bug is the mouse in the background attracts cats who scratch your monitor, causing permanent damage. I don't know why you're laughing. I don't know why.
Super cute.
This is a real problem, dude. This is a real problem.
How could we fix such a problem?
Depending on your feline installation base, it may not be a problem for you, because if you don't have a feline installed in your workflow, this may not affect you at all. Or if you have a lazy feline who doesn't care, you may also have a problem.
I've done a feline test and I am not susceptible to this bug. I've literally tried it. I literally took it to my cat and sat it in front of my cat and she just looked at it like I was a moron. Which is how cats look at everything. So.
I do believe though that they have the canine upgrade in the background on the backdrop. So if you do have a feline installed in your workflow, you can download the K9 version of the background, which should put the felines off actually trying to get involved with this, and hopefully will repel their appendages. This is a very serious problem. I don't believe more people aren't reporting on this. It's a very, very serious problem.
Just be careful though, because if you have the canine but you have hardware called dog, it can regress as well and destroy your completely destroy your computer altogether.
Yeah, people say that, but my feline is also a complete prick. So if he realized I didn't want him to be on the desk, he would only want to sit on the desk. So I have to allow him access at all times. They've done a good job here of documenting this bug. You can actually there's actually a full proper bug being posted about this. This is not just OMG Ubuntu. They've actually gone to the level of a Bugzilla post on this one, which apparently is not loading for me. I think maybe we're sending too much traffic their way and killing it. I can only assume. Yeah, we're sending all the traffic to it. That's not loaded for me at all, which is really weird. But yeah, they've actually gone to the effort of posting a bug report, and the patch was actually the dog wallpaper, which really made me laugh. That was gold. That was gold. Was other stuff? Didn't pay attention. What? Okay. Log. What did log say? No side loading CSS. Okay. I'm getting confused here with chat. It's losing me a little bit. So we'll move on.
Was literally updated this morning.
Okay. Tudo, I refuse to talk about Munich anymore. Do you want to take this one? I refuse to do it.
Oh, I just wanted to throw this in there to let everyone know that even the chief of IT of the whole Munich debacle and debate and whatnot is flat out saying there is no reason to go back to Windows. So this really, they've had the third party come in, which was a Microsoft shop, a third party recommendation come in and said there was nothing wrong with Linux. It was only wrong in the implementations. And now you literally have the head of IT come in and say there is no reason to go back to Windows, which everyone knew, but this clearly points to it just being a flat out political move that Microsoft bought off the politician to get Windows back into Munich. Fortunately, it was supposed to switch, but then the EFF got a stay on it in the courts for a justification for it. This is the most dramatic, over the top political bullshit.
Nonsense, yeah. Utter shit. Horse shit.
That Linux has seen since SCO, all the SCO crap. Yeah. So
I would my thoughts on this are easy.
Fine, chief.
It's not the city I've got a problem with, it's this asshole story. Munich's probably lovely. It's one of the places I one day want to visit, you know. To be clear, Munich seems lovely. I've got no problem with Munich people, Munich things, right? Just to put that out there. It really is on my list of places to visit. However, this fucking news item we've been covering since literally the first episode of X Penguin. That's how long this has been going on. And it was going on before then. At this point, do what you fucking like, Munich. Just shut the fuck up. Seriously, I'm sick of... Just do whatever you want to do, but you don't have to end up on the front page of Tech Republic every time someone mentions something. It's getting ridiculous. Pick a side and go with it. No one cares at this point. But I still have the mindset that this is... I kind of feel like Microsoft are really strong arm in this. I feel like they're offering some crazy stuff to get this happening. And I wonder if we'd have the same situation if money wasn't involved in politics. But anyway...
Yep.
What? They bought Munich by putting their main headquarters of Germany there. Did they? Microsoft did that, did they? That doesn't surprise me. Assholes.
Oh, yeah.
That doesn't surprise me at all. Okay. And the next item is AMD GPU LLVM expert has left AMD, now working for Red Hat. So, to be clear, some dude that was important in AMD GPU now works for Red Hat, and Sudo doesn't know why. But you must have him on speed dial. Aren't you the head of Red Hat now?
Oh, of course, yeah. Okay. We talked about it yesterday. He's directly making, there was no official announcement of it. It was just noted that he was making patches to RadV from a redhat.com email address, which just brought up the question to me is while Red Hat obviously has an investment in Linux and they support Linux developers, they literally got a guy from AMD GPU, so an expert in AMD GPU, to come work for them to work on, free and open source graphical things. Now, Red Hat isn't really a big desktop person. Yes, there's Fedora, but that is a community project that is kind of driven by Red Hat, and there are some developers paid for it. But it just piques my interest a bit of Red Hat's buying up some graphics developers. I wonder if we're going to see anything or whether this is just their investment back into Linux again. And you had an interesting
point. Yeah, my point is I think that Red Hat really, really want Wayland to be a thing. They want Wayland to be in everyone's computers because they don't want Mir to win. They don't want Mir. They want Wayland. So if they can put what is to Red Hat a fairly small amount of money in the hands of developers to push them to get Wayland working faster before Mir, it's in their best interest to do that all round, I think. I can't see how it works against them. And given the size of Red Hat and how much this would help them out, because every company goes, X is shit, X11 is shit. We need a better alternative. You know, we need something better. And yeah, so if they can put, if they can employ a couple of developers, give them a full-time job, and let this happen, why wouldn't they? You know, Smear.
Mir, more like Smear. Yeah, I like this. I like this a lot. I'm very excited about things like this, where it shows that, you know, companies built on open source are wanting to really invest back in open source by doing things like this, and not to get on a, you know, not to get on a pedestal, but this is kind of the reason why I wanted to join Red Hat, because guys, they believe me, being on the inside, they literally preach it every single day.
Yeah. And Glog78 says GPU computing. Yep. That's also a great point. Didn't think of that. I have got this photo on here, though.
There you go. That makes more sense.
I have got this guy's photo on here because it looks to me like he's got his thumb in his pants. It just looks really weird, the angle it's taken. Like he's got his thumb in his trousers. It's really weird. Just seems odd. Odd picture.
See, Glog, that would make more sense to me. That makes a lot of sense. Yep.
All in all, though,
that would also explain why he's contributing to RADV, because Vulkan is going to have better performance, and you know, GPU computing, you need the GPU for that. So there's, yeah, that's really cool. Yep. That's a good idea.
Good point. But the fact is, say what you like about Red Hat. I know a lot of people got issues with Red Hat for whatever reason, but my point of view is everything Red Hat do ends up open source, and they contribute and maintain. So who gives a shit what their political views are and what people's problems is? Fact is, this shit's going to end up public. So it's good, right?
And I agree with Cheese, you know, actually. What? When I first saw that picture, I'm like, this looks like it's from the 70s or 80s.
I didn't want to say it because I didn't want to look like I was being a dick, right? But this guy looks like, I'm going to be a dick now, and I know I'm being a dick, and if this guy ever watches, I'm really sorry, but I've got to say it. He looks like he's watched too many Bruce Lee movies, and he's going for that hair thing, right? And then he's like ready to pounce or something, yeah? And without the laptop, he's 70s as fuck. What the fuck's with that? Yeah, sorry. Anyway, sorry. Don't tuck your shirt in. Jesus Christ. What year is this? Who's tucked their shirt in? Is that a thing? I've never tucked
the
shirt in.
Look at
this chair. Those chairs, they're amazing. Maybe it's a time travel. It was taken in the 70s. But it will stop picking on him now. I'm glad someone else said it before me. But he does look like a thumb in his trousers, though, which is weird. But he's probably cool, and I'm sorry, he's probably super cool. Next one is, and then we'll just blast through the last two here, is Valve hires X11 veteran Keith Packard to work on the Linux display stack.
This was another one that was kind of like, Valve, while they don't say anything up front, this shows that they're actually investing back into what they want.
And apparently,
we all win.
Cheesiness has just told me that all the cool people took their shirts in. I should shut the fuck up.
Oh, shit.
But he actually said, I took my shirt in, which is the same thing. So
no, that's off-poll. Off-poll says.
Was it?
That.
No, Valiant says, I took my shirt in.
Oh, he does. Okay.
Oh, man. See, I don't tuck anything ever. I'm like loosey. Maybe it's because I'm a fat guy, but I'm like loose as fuck. I'm like you're lucky if I'm wearing trousers most of the time. I don't want it. I wear a dressing gown whenever I'm at home. I just like put pajamas. Like right now, you think I'm wearing a t-shirt. I'm only wearing a shirt because we're streaming. It's the only reason. Otherwise, no shirt, dressing gown. I'm a beast of a man, and I know it, you know? Anyway, but again, another one. The pictures on this are just shit. Just the pictures of this picture. Wow. Back to the topic, though. Valve hires X11 veteran. That's great. There's, like, Valve doing stuff. Yeah. It's great.
And they flat out tweeted it out saying, you know, they're 5 strong now, and they're still hiring people. They want shader compiler performance people especially, but it seems like Valve, while on the front side they don't say anything, on the back end they are very invested in something like this. They are growing their teams to invest back in Linux, and it's not just Valve that wins. We all win with something like this, and that's incredibly exciting.
If Valve and Red Hat alone, as well as all the other people doing it, keep pushing money and keep pushing developers and jobs, not only is it creating jobs in the open source space, but the human fucking race is benefiting from this sort of stuff. And I know it's like we're talking about games and it seems a bit silly, but you think about all this open source work and all this open source code. If you're new to code right now, there's so much cool projects to work on, so much cool shit. And this stuff ends up, like, this is like stuff you can put into any project. You're making a medical machine. You can now build an open source stack and use Vulkan to render it. Gone are the days when, like, copyright ruled, and thankfully we're seeing the end of that. It looks like it anyway, so I really hope it carries on. It's so good for the human race in general, and for me to play video games, which is the most important thing. I know I have that blind there is there because of my nudity. It's fine. That's the reason for the blind. It's cool. It's fine. Don't worry. I thought about the neighbors. Yeah, the human race benefits from it until the Internet of Things takes over and kills us all. Yeah, the Internet of Things is Skynet, absolutely, yeah.
But hey, even the Internet of Things is benefiting. See, we're all benefiting from this code.
Yeah.
That's why I love open source. We literally, even a kid on the other side of the world benefits from the code being open source. I just love it.
Yep, absolutely. Last item is Netflix. Yay! Update to HTML5 video for Netflix. They finally support Linux. Officially. I've been watching Netflix on Linux now for like 2 years.
So. Well, and this is specifically about Firefox on there as well, because before they were looking at the header and blocking it. I tried it. I can't get it running. I get some kind of weird error. I don't know. Text.
Yeah, I don't watch Netflix that often, right? I keep a subscription because my daughter watches it. I got a friend that's got access and she watches it. People watch my Netflix account, but I don't actually use it that much. But Iron Fist dropped and I was like, I want to watch Iron Fist. So I loaded up like Chromium, and Chromium went, now I've got the Widevine plugin, so it should work. We can't let you watch Netflix because you've got a VPN installed. Because you've got an ad blocker installed, sorry. And I went, okay, no problem. So I turned my ad block off and it went, no, you've got a proxy application installed. I was like, it's turned off. And it's like, we don't care. So I was like, fine. So then I disabled that. And then it going, no, your security settings are too high. And I was like, fuck you stupid fuckers. So I launched Chromium. I did the control shift N. And I launch it in incognito mode where all my extensions are turned off, right? And it goes, no, you can't watch Netflix because you're in incognito mode. And I was like, how the fuck does that make sense, right? So then I was like, I'll try Firefox. And I got some kind of fucked up error that, like, the error didn't load. Like, it said error number N34, and then there's no numbers. And I'm like, for fuck's sake. So in the end, the only browser I could watch Netflix on was fucking Vivaldi, of all things. I was just weirded out to fuck by that. But yeah, Vivaldi works fine, apparently. But nothing else does.
I've always run it on Chrome on my main television PC. It's just nice to see that it supposedly works in Firefox. And Glog says it does work on Arch. I'm on Energos. It just throws me some kind of error. But
oh, I know why.
Before this announcement, it would say you're not supported flat out because it would see the Firefox on Linux.
Yeah, I haven't updated in about a week. So I think I might not have the most recent software to even do this because, again, don't update before shows, and I've been very busy this week. So yeah, I think maybe when I update and maybe restart my computer, it's probably all going to work absolutely fine. So yeah, that's a thing. So that, ladies and gentlemen, brings us to the end of this week's X-Penguin episode, I think it was great having Pseudo back, wasn't it? It was good. Gave me a little bit of shit. Had some of that self-deprecating humor. Was knowledgeable on subjects. I think even though the other hosts we've had while Pseudo's been away have been admirable, and I would have either of them back again, they've been wonderful hosts, there's something special about the time we spend with Pseudo Shred. Don't ever leave the show.
Oh, gosh.
I screwed up there, Pseudo. While I was saying all that, I didn't have my Kappa phase loaded. Damn it. God damn it. Don't forget to change your wallpaper. If you've got a mouse on there, you'll lose a monitor or an arm in the case of my cat. I'm more worried about my cat hurting me than the computers. He's a fucking psychotic. So yeah, that brings us to the end of the show. Thank you to everyone who's watched, all 18 of you. Actually, the numbers was higher than that at one point. People seem to like what we do, so thank you very much for watching. I will not be streaming this evening, but I may be hanging out in the public chat over on Linux Gaming Group Discord if anyone is interested to hang out with me and maybe play some video games. Thank you all very much for coming. Our next episode of the show is on the 6th. Wait, hold on. I want to say the 6th of April. Am I wrong? Is it the 9th of April? Let me check. I've got the date written down and everything. Yeah, the 9th of April. The 9th of April. Where we may have a guest. I think we may have a guest for the 9th of April. I'm thinking it's looking good that we'll have a guest for that. So yeah, let me just double check I've got the dates right. Yeah, the 9th
of April. You should get some good guests on. Who would you recommend, Cheese?
Yeah, who do you recommend for the Cheeseness? Who do you recommend to be our guest for the 9th? Can you think of anyone? I don't know. Maybe Misu is available again. So yeah, thank you very much for watching, everyone. This is the end of the show. This, for those of you watching on YouTube, by the way, because a lot of people watch this show on YouTube, on the obviously not live on YouTube. That's where most of the viewers are, in fact. Thank you very much for watching. If you've got this far in the YouTube video, please consider pressing the like button and subscribe for more of this sort of content, as well as my wine adventures and other such lamey Linux gaming videos. Yeah, I put a video every single day, and I'm not getting jaded and bitter at all. So yeah, there's that. And you can get Pseudo where can we get you, Pseudo? You're on Twitter at PseudoShred.
Yeah, I don't really use that anymore.
Oh, and you're on Twitch at PseudoShred?
Yeah, I don't really stream anymore.
So you can get Pseudo here on this show. Or if you just email me, I'll make sure he gets the message. But he does hang out in the Linux Gamers Discord group all the time.
That's the best place to get. Yeah, our too. Discord's the best place to talk to me. Or you can email me at pseudoshred@protonmail.
Yep.
That's .com.
Yep, and I'm hexdsl@protonmail.com. But seriously, just type hexdsl into any decent search engine, and I'm usually the first 13 to 20 pages. So yeah, you'll have no problem. I've got a presence. It's okay. You'll find me. Thanks for watching, guys. We'll see you in 2 weeks. Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye.
Say goodbye, Pseudo Shred.
Goodbye, Pseudo Shred.
This is a tradition.